To Booze, Boobs, and Blood Podcast. I'm your humble host, Ween.
And I'm Ray.
Yay.
Yay. We're trying to get excited, guys. We're trying.
I'm not sure.
I mean, I have a lot of vitriol in my body right now.
I know. Look, I know that it seems like we're always hating on movies. We're really not. It's just, these are really bad. Okay.
Yeah.
So we're doing, what are we, Rip Miss Ray, tell us what we just reviewed, what shit shows we just watched.
Well, guys, we just finished Rob Zombie's 2007 Halloween and 2009 Halloween 2.
Boo.
Boo.
I don't think they really need to listen, right? They already have our reviews right now.
Wait, hold on.
I should really learn to write.
Fortnite.
Oh my gosh, like what is it? John Kroll in, I don't know, it's John, in Parks and Rec, the...
Oh, God.
What are the names, those douchey DJs?
Yeah.
Someone and the douche.
The douche.
And they always have fart noises galore. Yeah. That's what this was.
Weenie in the butt.
Yeah.
Before we get into this horrible massacre that is this awful movie, what's your pickle tickle?
What's up, my pickle? I'm getting fired the F up for Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
Meant a lot of people that I seem to come across don't, you know, a lot of people I know can, like, give or take Christmas, but they're, like, over Christmas before it even starts, and they're like, oh, everything's hyped up, commercialism, blah, blah, blah. I am a fan of Christmas. Mm-hmm. I fucking love Christmas more than most people. I decorate my apartment.
I've seen it. You have numerous trees.
I have a two-bedroom apartment and three trees. Mm-hmm. Do the math.
Do the math. Well, one's in your bedroom,
well,
I'm assuming.
Yes, yeah. One in each room, basically. I have, like, a mini tree in the bathroom. Mm-hmm. So, like, three and a half. I haven't brought everything up yet because things have come up this weekend and I've been mm-hmm. super busy, but I usually do it, you know, the day after Thanksgiving, but mm-hmm. I had a busy weekend, so I'm going to do that this week. I'm looking forward to it.
Fine.
Here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus. I am, you know, but it's the joy. Mm-hmm. I love the, call it an excuse for lack of a better word.
Everyone's in a better mood.
Or people are like, meh, it's okay, it's Christmas, or it's Hanukkah, or it's Kwanzaa, no worries, man. Or, like,
exactly.
It's a, I like any time of the year that, look, at its root, at its base, it's supposed to be a time to celebrate love and life with your friends and family. What's mm-hmm. better than that?
Exactly. 'Tis the season, bitches.
I mean, you could call that, you know, birthdays, but, you know, it's a birthday of sorts. Right?
Somebody's birthday.
Right, somebody. I mean,
Santa
6
Claus
months later, but...
Santa Claus.
It's fine. We've hardly talked about this movie because I'm just like, I just want to save everything.
Yeah.
I want to save it.
Yep.
For
and
you.
I don't want to be liable for anything. No, so I got an email on Friday in my work email.
Oh, great.
And I was like, the fuck is this? Because I have been known to get drunk and buy things. And I'm always like, duff. It's like that Patton Oswalt joke.
It's what you're known for?
Pretty much what I'm known for. He's like, but I remember that Patton Oswalt joke where he goes like, yeah, he's like, you know, I wanted to get drunk and buy stamps. I'm like, I need some stamps. And that's like me. I'm like, but I would never send it to my work.
I need a salad spinner. Fuck yeah. You know?
Exactly. It's 3 o'clock. I've had so many libations. But I woke up and I was like, hey, you won the eBay thing. I'm like, okay, so I know that this wasn't me because I won. It's not connected to my work email. And I don't remember buying this. So my boss bought me something. She had told me that she was buying me something for Christmas.
It wasn't a drunk buy.
No, that's not a drunk buy.
Well, that's good.
She bought me a life-size cutout of Tom Ellis. I don't know if you guys don't know who Tom Willis is, he's the guy who plays Lucifer on Lucifer.
Where is it? Wait, why? I'm at Ray's house and I do not see it.
It's not here yet. It'll be here next week.
Are you putting? Please tell me you're putting a Santa hat on it. Please tell me you're putting a Santa hat.
Yes, thank course. God. And we're gonna have to make the recording of the baby because that's where it's going. Because she made a comment about I have all this artwork downstairs that's up. I don't think you've been down since I put the artwork up, but I've got a Lichtenstein up and an a Pollock and stuff. And she was like, "Where's your Tom Ellis? Where's Tom Ellis? Where's the life size cutout of Tom Ellis?" I go, "Well, when he starts doing some contemporary artwork." And I can hang it up, then we'll talk. So yeah, that's where that came from. Oh no, there's gonna be, I'm sure,
Lovely though. She's nice adorable. Of your boss. Yeah.
She goes, I'm not gonna do this. She's like, I don't do this every year for everybody. She goes, like, if I find something perfect.
You're special. Yeah. Well, yes. And like she said, it is perfect.
Yeah.
It is perfect.
Yeah. Because he's perfect.
You can't, once you see it, you can't not go, that's for Ray. That's right? Ray
Ellis, right? I mean, it's funny because like, I don't know anything about this guy besides like Lucifer and he's hot. And I have a friend of mine who I got it. I was like, you need to watch Lucifer. You love it. She knows more about him now. I'm like, oh, he's from Wales.
Really? Is it Veronica?
It's not Veronica.
No. Okay, I was curious.
No.
Sweet.
Yeah, so that's my pickle tickle.
Oh my gosh.
All right. Let's take a break.
Yeah.
All right, come back.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck me. And we're going to do this.
Here we go.
We'll be back in two
for the Hellbillies. Yeehaw! And we're back.
Oh, here we go. Back. Back to fight. Okay.
So remember what I said last time about, or maybe it wasn't the last time, the time before, where I quoted that one guy talking about stripping the mystery from, you know.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. That's just out the window now with Rob Zombie's vision of Halloween and Michael Myers and Laurie Strode and all the, our fun cast of characters. So when they said, make it your own.
that too.
It's basically the same chronological setup-ish, except for the very beginning. The first first 20 minutes of the movie. No, hold on, I have that. Damn, I thought I put the time. I guess not. But like halfway through begins where the very, very first movie began.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, I have to get like really through this. So my first note is the following. This makes no sense. This is bullshit.
Cool. Can I tell you
sure
a little bit about backstory?
Oh, the production. Please do.
Okay, because this is all the production you bitches are gonna get because no. I couldn't give two fucks to sit and watch a 4-hour behind the scenes. I made it 45 minutes, and I wanted to give myself a sainthood.
If I wanted to watch somebody jack off for that long. I could just join webcams. Right. Oh, yeah. I mean, you did watch the documentary.
I meant to say, like, porn, but, you know.
Yeah, that's what I mean. So, Ray also sent me the link. Like, it's on YouTube, I believe, this four-hour documentary about behind the scenes.
Michael Lives, I think it's what it's called.
Yeah, of Rob Zombie's Halloween. And Ray here got all the way through it, yeah?
45 minutes.
No, you got 45 minutes in.
Yeah.
I got about 5 minutes in before I wanted to kill somebody, particularly Rob Zombie. Mm-hmm. The first 5 minutes is pure, it's just cameras following Rob Zombie around and him complaining and whining about various things.
Eating McDonald's.
And eating McDonald's,
I did pick out a couple things that I thought were interesting. So in 2006, we get this Dimension announces they're going to reboot with Rob Zombie. And Akkad is back on the scene. He's like, he tells Rob, you can pretty much do what you want. Rules are out the window. So you could kill Michael if you want.
Oh, mm-hmm. No more contractual obligation mm-hmm. to keep him pumping.
Cool. No. Cool. And like you said, John Carpenter's told Rob Zombie, make it his own.
Yeah.
And Zombie wanted to, you know, scare Michael Myers up again. He said that he became too, like, familiar to audiences, like, like Freddy.
Sure.
And I'm doing the jack-off motion.
Yes, as you're doing it. Yeah. She is. I can attest.
So, and then the other thing he wanted, this was a line that I could not fucking get over. Rob Zombie literally said, was he trying to kill Laurie or find her because he loves her? The fuck are you talking about?
That wasn't even clear in his own movie. What the hell?
So what I really find funny is in the first like 10 minutes of this Michael Lives thing, he has the fucking gall to say, Zombie, I don't want any cameos. It means you don't take your movie seriously. This fucking movie is full of
them.
All it is fucking cameos.
Yeah, Danny Trejo,
Chris Hardwick.
No, that was the second
one, but still.
But the first one we had fucking
Sid Haig,
Malcolm McDowell. For fuck's sake! I mean, not a cameo, but like,
yeah, there's cameos all over this fucking thing.
Are you kidding me?
That's what he said. I was like, you go fuck yourself, dude. Oh my god. Yep. So the one thing I kind of want to talk about too. The first thing is, they literally start shooting this fucking thing in order.
Yeah.
You don't do that. Production doesn't do that. It just shows you how much he doesn't know what the fuck
doesn't
he's doing.
Doesn't know about now.
You don't film... Oh my god, you don't film a movie in order. It doesn't work like that. This isn't fucking Ed Wood, okay?
Right.
I do want to talk about the mask. Because I think we're on differing in opinions on this one.
Okay.
I like the mask. And what I liked about it is because they actually took Tyler Mane, who plays Michael, who's pretty fucking hot.
He's a little easy on the eyes there. He is. You should look at his IMDb picture. Is like he's a bald-headed lumberjack, like with a nice beard. Oh,
but in this behind the scenes, did you see him in the behind the scenes?
Yeah,
he had some hair. Oh, he
no,
was...
I only got 5 minutes in.
Okay,
and I was like,
who is that dreamboat? Holy shit! He's also like 6'9".
Yeah,
he's enormous.
legit huge.
He's huge.
Yeah.
So what they did is they did a mold of his face. Now, and so the mask is actually Tyler Mane's face.
Okay.
Yeah, and so I was like, that's actually pretty genius.
Yeah,
because I thought the hair looked okay with it, and I thought the mask itself, because they really do dirty that, it's the same masks for both. And I really like the continuity in the second one. Is at one point towards the end she rips part of it off. And it's partially gone, and it's not a new mask in the next one.
Yeah.
So I do have to say, and they made 6 masks. They made 3 clean masks and 3 rotted masks.
Yeah.
And
that tracks. Well, yeah. Yeah. You have to have blame. For purposes of the plot, I will save my comments on the mask later.
Okay.
But I didn't. I thought it was like, you know, we're trying to find the positive, guys.
I mean,
trying to find any positivity in this ridiculousness. That's definitely a plus.
Well,
the mask was well done.
If I had to look at 7 and I had to compare 7 in this, the masks, I would
please
take this one.
Please. Oh yeah,
in a heartbeat.
Agreed.
Yeah,
agreed on that.
So we got a 27% on Rotten Tomatoes on this one. This is the higher of the two. So, so what year do you think this is? Yeah, well, what year do you think this movie takes place?
So, I have a note about that. It's not clear to me.
Mm-mm, but it is. I did find it.
Did you now?
What year would you put it? If you had to name a decade.
I would say, like, okay, so the movie opens up with 8-year-old Michael, not 6.
No, he's
10.
11, I think.
Hold on, actually. He's 10.
He's 10, okay.
Yeah, he was 10-year-old Michael, not 6.
Right.
I would say the late 80s.
You're close. It's supposed to take place in 1990. The clothes threw me. I was like, this looks like 1970. Because what Sherry wears looks like something from Good Times.
Anyway.
Okay.
Yeah.
Enter the hillbillies.
Okay, so the movie opens with
we are not hiding that this
way back
is, that there is a baby. We're not hiding that Michael's got a
definitely
sister.
Is. We open up with whatever fucking year this was, 1990, and it was not clear. Yeah. And I think, you know, he wanted it to be ambiguous for a reason, possibly, whatever, or laziness. So either way, we open up with backstory for Michael.
Yeah.
Opening up that way. And it starts with a 10-year-old Michael, a 17 question mark year old Judith.
Yeah.
16, 17.
Yeah. She can drive.
Yeah. So I'm thinking 17. Mm-hmm. And a baby toddler, baby
Boo.
Baby, I think that's cute.
Better than Boo. The real name.
Angel.
It's fine.
I didn't realize that until the next one, but anyway.
I didn't either. I was kind of like, really?
Okay. Yeah. Okay. That was her adoptive name, was Lori Strode. That's what they're, okay. Age is also not clear, I think, on the baby, on who will be Lori later on. I think she's too young to be two, though.
Because she's infant.
Yeah, because she's still not got a lot of hair. So I would say one at the most.
Mm-mm. Yeah. I'm going to guess like 9, 10 months. Because
she's still pretty bald-headed baby.
Yeah. Adorable so cute. Baby. The cutest baby.
Oh, yeah.
Well, we open with Sherry Moon Zombie. Can you have negative acting talent?
It's possible.
I mean, in this film. God, she's awful.
Yeah, not great. She's just there to be naked because obviously her character is a stripper.
What? Duh. I was like, really? That's great.
So Michael's mom is a stripper.
We don't get a name on her, do we? Deborah. I guess her name's Deborah.
Myers. And is married to some temporarily.
They're not married.
Oh, they're not married. Great.
Ronnie. She's making breakfast.
Yeah.
And he's crippled.
Temporarily handicapped or permanently because, it, you know, but this was a, you know, an unfortunate stereotype, typical thing of like, you know, very poor families.
Oh.
Where, you know, dudes doing blue collar work, they get hurt and they're out of work for fucking ever. Yeah. And then their only, you know, vice is to live on the government, which is not much money, as people who are living off government money know, you know, strictly off of Social Security or workman's comp, whatever.
This is taking the workmen and putting them in the absolute fucking worst light.
Yeah, yeah.
It is like...
This guy's a piece of garbage.
What is the first line that comes out of his fucking gob? I will crawl over there and skull fuck the shit out of you.
Yeah.
Awesome. Thanks,
lots of,
guy.
Lots of language.
Thank you. We're going to talk about the language.
Yeah.
We'll get to that in a second.
I paused this about 8 minutes in, and I'm like, 8 minutes in, that's all you need. 5 minutes, even.
Yeah.
It's blatantly dirty. Clear that everything, every person in this family is a piece of garbage.
Everything is fucking filthy.
So, like, which...
The kitchen's filthy. The kids are filthy. Michael's fingers are... Well, we're also up. Michael's upstairs in his bathroom after he gets this adorable rat.
Playing with his little pet rats.
Elvis. Well, we don't know. We don't luckily see what he does to Elvis. We know that he stabs and kills Elvis.
Because when Judith comes up to get him for breakfast, Michael is washing blood off of his hands.
And
there's no more rat.
And then we get a wonderful, like, she's making fun of him, like, masturbating with the rat. I'm like, okay.
I'm sorry, what?
Yeah, like when they come back down. So we get also tons of transphobia. Awesome.
Yeah.
Fucking awesome.
I mean, name it. They do.
I mean, so Ronnie, our buddy Ronnie says, well, he's going to end up cutting off his dick and balls and changing his name to Michelle.
Yeah.
Can we, about I wrote Michael. At one point, can we just flush this whole family to the toilet?
Right.
Seriously?
Can I just fast forward this? It really is useless what they say, anything they say. The only thing that is being established here is that Michael has a dumpster fire of a life. That
and
is
his mom
it.
Loves him.
Right. I said, so Michael has a dumpster fire of a life. Got it.
Yeah.
Also, it's logical that a child with a proclivity to killing animals tends toward the sociopathic and, given his home life, is anyone surprised?
Yeah.
Anyway?
Nope.
Nope. Anybody?
No. Really? And we are also treated to Ronnie sexually harassing the daughter also. So that's awesome.
Great.
Cool.
He talks about her ass in front of the mother.
She's kind of into it a little bit, which I was kind of like, I'm uncomfortable.
I did not catch that.
With this. Like,
I did not catch that.
She was like, you're a shit. But like, she gave him a look. I'm like, I don't like any of this, people.
No, all of it sucks.
This is awful.
Please. God. Somebody called CPS, please.
So then we get to school.
Yeah. Oh, and he's, you know, even at home, he has a little clown mask that he wears. That's just a little quickie, like, cute little pull down. It's not cute, but it's pretty brightly colored. He's obsessive about his mask. It's both his protection and identity. Mm-hmm. Again, to Zombie's credit, is anybody surprised? Like, he's setting up some obvious reasons why Michael ends up the way he does. This is not like this. It unfortunately, it's a stereotype. Look at any serial killer. Mm-hmm. They were either, you know, horribly abused or came from abuse or witnessed something traumatic. And I can talk about that later, because there's a documentary about. So we get to middle school. I said, don't know how old Michael is, presumably in middle school. It's later said, I think at this point, this is when Dr. Loomis comes to the office about him and that he's 10. And I said, he otherwise seems like a typical young boy. Like, he's not, apart from killing the rat that morning.
Right. And then the pictures come out.
It didn't seem. Yeah.
It did. Because, he gets in a fight with a bully in the bathroom. Yeah. Spy Kid. He's the kid from Spy Kids. Yeah. And they have
cameos.
Ha! Yeah, right. They have a cutout from the newspaper of his mom from the strip joint, the Red Rabbit, and they're going to make copies of it. Which that should have been my first indication.
The bully. Yeah,
that like it was earlier, because they wouldn't have had. It'd have been harder for them to get like
out of
photocopies.
Newspaper, right?
Yeah. So, so he. They start fighting, and Principal Chambers breaks them up, and Michael tells him to fuck you a number of times.
Yeah.
And so the mom... Yeah,
because that's what he hears at home.
Yeah. And this is when Dr. Loomis is coming... Like you said, Dr. Loomis is there, and they start pulling out these photographs that Michael has in his locker.
His little sash, yeah.
Yeah. And they're of all these cats and dogs murdered.
In various stages of decay. Mm-hmm. Dead animal, you know, they obsessed with dead animals and looking at,
I love this Deborah, who goes, I gotta get back to work. I was like, it's like fucking 10 o'clock on a Monday. Is the strip joint even open?
Right,
like,
right.
What's going on the strip joint? And they're like,
maybe she was lying because she just wanted to get the hell out of there.
Could be. I just laughed at that. I was like,
but you're a stripper, please.
Yeah, I mean,
your job begins at 9 p.m. at best.
I'm like, no offense to strippers. I'm just I'm just like,
they could be working happy hour. Who knows?
I guess. I mean,
maybe she's got to do the accounting too.
Maybe she's like cooking.
Multiple responsibilities.
She's working the books and working the pole.
Boom.
My gosh. Oh, let's see. God.
Where's our fart noises?
I know. Wisdom around the time is. Michael, this is where we see Michael's first murder.
Yeah, of a human.
Of a human.
Human being.
So poor Wesley Spy Kid fucking gets it.
Oh man, does he.
I mean, this was...
It's not wholly unsurprising.
No. That one was... It's just violent. It's really
extremely violent.
Violent.
He beats him to death with, like, a branch half his size.
Yeah. And I actually worry about this child actor. Like, it had to... although he seemed really excited in the back behind the scenes, but, like, that had to be traumatizing. Like, for me, I was traumatized, and I was, like, just watching it. I can't imagine.
Yeah.
And Zombie was a little too gleeful himself.
Wow.
To be like, I was like, you need to temper this a little bit, because this is going to mess this fucking kid up. Because
he's got the same mentality. So, of course, he was fucking. Anyway, sorry. That's a cheap shot. I'm sorry. I said, there's the mask. So many psychological Freudian issues here. It's not even worth delving into. So,
Jesus.
Of course, I didn't put what part that was. Okay. I now have back at the house. This was before the first kill. Or this right after. Before the second kill.
Yeah.
So I'll let you go.
Oh, Deborah just tells Judith to make to that she has to take her trick or treating.
Right.
Which I was still, I was like,
ooh. Which Judith is stoked about.
Yeah. Which she's like, go fucking do it yourself, and then goes get fucked by Steve. Steve, right? Steve.
I don't know who fucking
Steve,
cares.
I think his name's Steve.
Whatever her boyfriend. Douchey boyfriend.
He was gross.
He's Steve. The one.
Yeah.
Her douchey boyfriend is the one that brings the mask.
Is he?
Uh-huh.
Oh, that's right. That's oh, I forgot what mask we were talking about, because we were just talking about the
mask.
The mask. Because as they're fucking having sex, he puts this creepy-ass mask on.
Right. And she's like, da fuck, dude. Take that off.
Yeah.
Ugh. She's like, it's hideous. What the... What are you... You know... And it is the, what we now know as the Michael Myers mask,
yes.
The blank, you know, whatever. And I said, chilling, eating some candy, watching a movie. I think I'll kill my stepdad
now. I was like
now.
Contemplating killing someone.
Right.
Which he slept through getting duct taped to a chair.
He was very intoxicated. Kids have little hands? Question mark? I don't know. Ray was looking at me like, is it? Yeah, it's pretty loud.
And then also, I mean, he duct taped the shit out of him.
Yeah.
So he duct tapes Ronnie to the chair.
Ronnie, yeah.
I have to say, this was a good kill. I liked it.
I agree. He's not ragey at all.
No, this was
just
very
calmly. This is the classic Michael we mm-hmm. see. Or the cut that kind of, it's just quiet, just watching.
Yep, slits his throat. And I have to say, the special effect, the special effects on this one were really good.
Yeah.
Really?
Well, yeah.
Yeah. Good on you, zombie, for one good kill.
Yeah. In all fairness, I have not seen House of a Thousand Corpses.
I have seen.
Or any.
I've seen both. I've
so
seen
how would you rate
the two?
That movie?
It's the same thing. It's this.
I mean, that's kind of what...
It's a stick. It's just spiel. I mean, Devil's Rejects
is
worse. Oh,
As far as special effects goes. Because I'm assuming, you know, he has some good buddy pals. Because given the nature of his music, you know.
Yeah, they're okay. I mean, one thing I have to say is, like, the special effects in these movies aren't bad. They're over the top and fucking too much.
Yeah.
But I think practical, they're fine.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
I mean, I have
Slasher.
An issue with Annie's death in the second one, because I have an issue with logistically.
Yeah.
But,
yeah, I agree.
So now we get.
I'm way fast forwarded. So
oh
you
no
go.
No. Steve goes down and make himself a sandwich because he's like in and out, bitch.
Right.
And upstairs.
All the stereotypes.
Oh yeah, and so. We get Steve's death. He gets beaten up with a baseball bat.
Aluminum
bat. Rough.
Bat.
Especially since I saw that behind the scenes, and I was like, Jesus Christ. And you watch him just... You watch this tiny child just beat the shit.
Like, yeehaw!
Yeah. I'm like, oh my God, I can't. And
yeah.
But again, we have a nice, like, the special effects with the blood coming out. We could see that, too, in the behind the scenes. It's cool.
Yeah. That's shit is kind of interesting.
Next up we get Don't Fear the Reaper, and I just wrote,
yep.
You didn't earn this, asshole.
Ah!
So
nice.
Zombie decides we're gonna go back up to Judas listening to music on her headphones, which are definitely from like 1970.
Yeah, she's got just like a slip on or a half slip or
yeah
something like
she's
that.
At least got clothes on,
yeah,
which is unusual, which I it's different
sure.
from the other so
sure.
questions.
Michael comes up to her.
I have this.
Yeah.
I'm like, why? Okay,
why?
Go ahead. I'll let you.
No,
you go for it.
It's the so Michael.
This is creepy.
Goes up to her with his little clown mask. While after he beat Steve to death, goes upstairs to Judith's room with his, you know, with a knife. Is this where he has? Yeah, he has a big ass butcher knife. Goes to Judith's room, and she's, like, laying on her side with her back toward the door where, like, little Michael's coming in. He's got his clown mask down, his protection, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's not, you know, outwardly said, but that's, you know,
yeah.
he's not him anymore.
Right.
Behind the mask. Goes up to his sister and, like, lightly...
It's
with
sexual.
His little baby hands,
mm-hmm.
lightly caresses her thigh, straight up to her butt.
He does.
From the knee to the butt.
And he does the other side of it. It's not even the palm side down.
It's like how some people might, put their fingers in the water.
Yeah, it's a sexual thing.
And she thinks, naturally, that it's her boyfriend. And she's yeah.
And we only see the one stab. But she supposedly was stabbed everywhere.
Yeah.
But we only see the one in the stomach.
Yeah.
And then she stumbles into the hallway.
There's a lot of this in the Rob Zombie Halloweens. Almost every single female that he kills. Almost every single one. He, stabs a couple times, however many. They get up. Start to crawl away and cry and help and whatever. Mm-hmm. And he just slowly, as they're crawling, it's like that's the thing he likes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is they're helpless and crawling away and they can't, there's nowhere they can go.
Which, you don't earn that, asshole.
Yeah.
You don't earn that. I mean, if you're going to have all this backstory.
Right.
What would be the impetus for Michael to be like that with women? His mother loved him. We see his mother loved him. So what is the impetus of being so violent towards women in this
movie? Women. So sister's crawling away from him and shit. And like you said, it's like the hunt. It's like the, domination thing. And the whole sexual thing, his sister's not great to him.
Right.
So is that it? But it's like that abusive, being sexually attracted to your abuser or one of them. Because she's probably just as abusive as everybody else is. She is verbally, anyway, to him. So, but he's, a little boy growing up and he's at that age. He's 10 now. He's at that age where he's probably looking at, curious about, females. I don't know,
because Steve didn't seem really nasty to him. In fact, he was like, sorry, dude. He was kind of like...
Yeah, no, Steve, yeah. Steve
was so like... I'm like, I don't know. I don't know what it is. It's because there was no reason for him to... Well, unless he did. He is sexually attracted to his sister.
And that's what I mean. Steve, his sister, maybe. Not his mom.
Well, you know, maybe that his that's sister, why he killed Steve. Yeah. Because they had just had sex.
Right. He got to do it and she didn't. Just kidding. But gross. But
I mean, that thing, it was one of those... Did we need this in this movie?
Yeah. Did we need any of this?
No, we didn't need this movie. No. Will the world be a better place? Possibly.
Rob Zombie needed this movie for his fucking fantasies.
So we also then...
Yeah. Ronnie's gone. Steve is gone. Judith's gone. Who's left? Baby.
And he picks up the baby. And the baby... They specifically wanted the baby to be happy when Michael came in.
So, yeah.
And they were
because most babies are fucking...
They don't fucking know that.
When they see someone they recognize, they're fucking stoked.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And he was probably... And probably appreciated that she was this,
only one that loved him.
Slightly different, but slightly different from animals. This is where I'm confused. Mm-hmm. You could say the same argument for animals. Especially his own pets, the rats and things. Surely they appreciated him. He fed them and cared for them. And some children, people find love that way. Yeah. Why was it different with animals versus his baby sister? When they had the same sort of reactions and interaction, because she could verbalize her love for her love, to him and everything. So I don't know. I was curious. So at first I was like, oh fuck no. But of course they weren't.
Right.
So cut to the mom gets home, comes home, finds Michael that has the mask on at this point.
No, was sitting on the front step.
He was sitting on the front step, but I think he had his mask on. He had it.
He had it. I don't think he had it.
I don't know if it was down or up.
He was up.
But he was holding baby. Baby on the front step, and he's kind of covered in blood and ish, and she's mom's like, what are you doing? Then cut to this montage of news reporters, cops.
You look like a vampire from Dark Shadows. The was like, what makeup did they put on this fucking guy? Like, God. He looked awful. Anyhow,
so bad. And this is where I found out he was 10. Because the guy was like, you know, 10-year-old Michael Myers. Report. My God. We totally missed the school thing, didn't we?
No, we talked about school.
Dr. Loomis being there and talking to her? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
And this is like, now Loomis is like, told ya. Bingo.
I don't want to be a little dicky poo, but I kind of pointed this out.
As a rope. Nice hair, Loomis. Oh, that hair was something the fuck else.
Malcolm McDowell. Fucking.
So we get to love that guy. I do, man. Too. We get to see. He gets put away. I was like, this doesn't happen like this. No. Like, I mean, he gets put away, but they're like, he was convicted of murder. I was like, the 10-year-old's
not. He's not tried as an adult. No.
No. So.
No. That's not how that works.
Yeah.
Get a law book. he has apparently Michael. So we cut to Michael being locked up. He's locked up in the sanitarium.
Which, where are the other patients? There's like nobody in this fucking place.
Apparently nobody else. But apparently.
Extras. There's too many, like, could pay for extras.
Right. But apparently, Dr. Loomis, played by Malcolm McDowell, was salivating to have, you know, some company, I guess, and have somebody to take care of in the institution. So he has Michael now. Michael apparently has no memory of this.
No.
When he starts being, you know, doing therapy sessions with Dr. Loomis, he apparently has no memory of this, or is this an act? Who's paying for his care at said sanitarium? The state?
State, because I'm assuming it's the state. It was probably, like, because he's not going to...
Yeah. Can't go to jail.
Yeah, can't go to jail. That would be, like, a...
he would have gone to juvie.
Juvie.
Right.
So, but they were like,
That's not what he means.
I just wrote, oh, Danny Trejo, just stop. Just please stop acting.
Danny Trejo!
I love him, but he needs to stop acting. Like, he's not a good actor.
No, you don't get Danny Trejo because he's an amazing actor.
You get
him
because he's Machete.
That's exactly why.
So Danny Trejo is the only orderly that's nice to him in the hospital.
Yeah. Oh, and that bummed me out because he was totally right.
And then he starts making these masks, and at one point Deborah's visiting, and he's got this fucking horrible abomination on his face, and she's like, oh yeah, beautiful. And I wrote, is it
he later, you know, his mom comes to visit him. Okay, legit though, that poor fucking lady.
It's almost easier to see in the 1978 version it being more true to life. Like, fuck no, you know.
It was shocking to me that she actually would, you know, go visit him and be as pleasant and everything. She did love him. She really loved him. Little Michael is, you know, visiting with his mom, and he has that mask, and she's like, you know, I want to see your face. You're my baby. I want to see you. And he said his mask hides his, quote, ugliness.
Yeah.
Metaphorically speaking, hopefully. Otherwise, zombie is a hack. But I'm like, so ugliness, what does he mean by ugliness?
Right.
Like his physical appearance of his face? That what never really done? Seemed it. Right. That could mean a whole bunch of things.
But which we don't get into. Which we don't.
No,
we
it's
don't
never addressed. To. Never yeah, addressed. Well, sure.
It's one of those, you can't. These are all half-baked ideas.
Yeah.
If you're going to go all out, fucking go all out and make this whole movie just his. The first part of this.
We all got botulism because of all the half-baked ideas.
Yes! We're on the toilet for 3 days because of this fucking movie.
Thank you for food poisoning us all.
But, like, seriously, you Jesus. Can't throw everything in. He would have been better as to split this. If he wanted to go hog wild with this whole backstory, split this movie into two.
Yeah.
Right. Make the second half with...
It was very rushed.
Which Angel... Your second movie.
Yeah.
But because, we don't tie this up. What do you think? If you're just throwing this shit out.
You wanted to bother taking any time creating a backstory, but people wouldn't have gone to see that.
I don't know, because people saw the Leatherface movie, and that was like the beginning of Leatherface.
Ed Gein?
No. There's a movie called Leatherface. I've seen it.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh. I mean, it's
I'd watch that, but that's because I'm a documentary and information nerd.
Well, but it's a movie. It's not like a doc, but it's like, but it's like
story.
It's, yeah, right. It's a, but it talks about how, you know, that Leatherface character came to be. Yeah, you know what I'm saying. The origin story. I mean, that's what he's trying to create here. It's like, then fucking do it.
Right.
Like, don't rush it for 30 minutes. Dude. Yeah.
Don't just the tip. And pop psychology and whatever.
Yeah.
I wrote, so, you know, we're still with Michael at the sanitarium. He's still 10, 11, maybe this is a year later or something. Does he understand at all why he's incarcerated? Has no one told him?
No.
And for a long time, no one did, because he kept saying, I want to go home, or I can't wait to go home.
Well, we get his
Nobody's fucking.
We get his trigger.
Yep.
Which, again, don't explain it. So the last trip we see, Mrs. Myers make, is he hasn't been talking talking for 2 weeks, and at this point Loomis is suggesting shock therapy, and Deborah has brought a picture of baby Boo and Michael, and
he's becoming more withdrawn, as you do, locked in a cage,
right, on Thorazine, which we know from this medication, but he's starting to talk less and less, be more communicative
and shut off. Right. He's starting to shut down.
Right.
He even says at some point, you know, I hate this world. I have that written down.
So they leave
And at
him.
That point, then Dr. Loomis decides to tell him that it's now a good idea to tell him that he cannot go. He's not going home.
Right. Right. Yeah. Good times. Well, and then we also, they leave him with a nurse.
Mm.
And all she says was, cute baby, right? Isn't that
Yeah, on the picture.
And that's all she says. I don't think there was anything malicious about it.
No.
Because she's just sitting there. I mean, I don't...
Because Dr. Loomis was walking the mom out, and he's like, can you watch him, you know, for a bit? Sure. She's like, yeah, chill.
So she sits down,
and she's trying to make
small talk with him. And she picks up the picture, and she goes, cute baby. And then she puts it back down, and she starts, I don't know, looking at her something.
Magazine. Something.
And he just starts fucking stabbing her with the fork.
Yeah.
I just wrote picture equals murder fuel.
Guess.
So a picture of his baby sister.
I don't know if it was the picture. I think it was.
Yeah, it was.
I mean, I know the picture was there, but was it the picture that triggered him? Or was he just?
I think it was weird that it was saying cute baby, not saying fuck the world. It was the cute baby part that was the trigger. Again, these are half baked ideas. Who knows?
Right.
Who fucking knows?
Fair.
So then, again, I wrote, is there no one else in this fucking hospital?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, there's literally, like, no one else in this hospital.
Yeah, nobody. Anyway.
So now we get the...
Now he's truly... So after he kills the nurse, he's truly obsessed with a mask. He's becoming more silent and despondent, and now he's lashing out, kill the nurse. And now his mother just killed herself.
And I wrote... Who gonna take care of that baby?
I know.
She just blows her brains out. I was like, but
when you're at that kind of psychological break, you're probably not thinking, and she probably couldn't live with herself not seeing Michael or not, you know what I mean?
But what about the
baby? She couldn't just cut and run.
Wasn't like, hey, somebody check on the baby? Because there's nobody to come check on the baby.
Oh, right. Maybe she thought it would be,
I don't know.
That's not a merciful death, letting a baby starve, but maybe, I don't know. Again, half-baked.
So we learn this later, but I'm going to bring it up now because it's easier for the plot. Sheriff Brackett is the one who comes to the house.
Brackett. The first time, right?
When she shoots herself.
Oh, right.
Because he takes the baby and he takes it to a hospital. He takes him to the hospital the town over.
Yeah.
Well, his buddy, I forgot his name, Mitch, I don't know what his name is, Strode, they were wanting to adopt a baby. And so 3 months later, he finds out, or 3 weeks later, I think he says, he finds out that the Strodes have adopted this baby. So he's kept it for that long.
Yeah.
But that's what happens after that. We get this line. Well, first... Tyler Maines is huge.
He's fucking massive.
We get
6'9". As tall as LeBron James.
So fucking hot. Man. He's hot.
not with that fucking wig and
no, ugh. No. But I can only imagine the rest of it. Okay. This is where Mr. Dr. Loomis is like, he's so grown up. He's all grown up.
Wait, okay, sorry.
No, go for it.
15 years later, after mm-hmm. the monkey, then we go 15 years later. He has now remained silent all this time. Aw, Dr. Loomis is breaking up with Michael so he can sell his book.
Yeah, I was like, okay.
They had to have the talk. The talk, yeah.
It's not you, it's me.
Hello, it's me.
Well, he literally says, in a weird way, you've become my best friend. Nope. Nope.
You don't tell him that.
No. Become my cash cow, is what it is. Yeah, right. You
become my meal ticket. Thanks so much.
I'm going to go write a book called
Because he's like, Eyes. I can't do anything for you, so I'm going to write a book. Bye. Bye.
Yeah, the devil's eyes.
Ugh.
So now, I don't know exactly why. Where are they just moving him?
Yeah.
They're just moving him.
A more maximum security something or other because he cannot be.
So there's two different versions of this. There's a theatrical version and an unrated version. I think we saw the theatrical.
Possibly.
Yeah.
Because he was being moved and he was chained up. And
this is where we get, we get my buddy, Bill Moseley. I was like, speaking of fucking cameos, Bill Moseley, this is the cameo of cameoists.
I know!
Besides, I was like, oh, God. So anyhow, yeah, cameos of cameos. Fucking Bill Moseley's in this fucking movie.
Right, Bill Moseley. Brad Dourif.
Yes! Well, do we really want to count that cameo? No. Because he's, like, in it. He's bracket.
We'll say well-known actors randomly are in these parts.
I mean, Danny Trejo is, you know, in, so they're transferring him.
Oh, transferring him. He's all in chains and shit.
He literally breaks free of his chains. Well, he is 6'9" and a fucking beast. Breaks out of his chains.
Fucking bullshit. That is not possible but Michael is that fucking strong to break his chains like that. I'm calling bullshit.
You know what I'm saying? Steel balls wrapped all around me. Michael Bolton, bitch.
What is that? What did you just sing to me? You can't even. She's broken. She broke herself.
Michael Bolton. Okay.
Oh.
I know. I kind of hate myself for it, but it's worth it. It's worth it for the laugh that I just got. I gave to myself.
I oddly love you more for it. It's our fucked up friendship. Anyways. Oh. Yep. No. Mm-hmm. I thought you were going to say movie magic.
Well, movie it magic.
Is. Sure.
Well, so he pretty much killed.
Because ain't nobody taught him how to drive. Ain't nobody.
Oh, FYI, he doesn't drive in this.
No, he does not. He does not drive in this movie.
No. He doesn't.
So there's a plus. Ding, ding, ding. Okay. I need a bell. No, I don't.
No. I'm gonna veto against that one.
You do have veto power. This is your house.
I do. And I edit.
Okay.
The only cool, and I'm using cool in air quotes, about this whole scene is the throat rip. The throat rip is pretty rough.
Oh, man! Yeah!
Pretty rough. It was gory. But as we're talking about practical, the practical's not bad. I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I enjoyed it.
Yep.
So it was nasty.
So he does, and Ishmael is. That's what's his face?
Danny Trejo.
Yeah.
Oh, I was bummed out. Yeah. He was
always nice to you, Mikey.
Yeah, I was good to you.
I was good to you, Mikey.
I was always good to you. I was good. And he was. He, like, you know, like, through for all, what, 15, 16 years that Michael is there, and, like, you know, this. You work in a, you know where you are. You work in a mental institution. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, it reminded me of something said in The Green Mile, like, these people are at a psychic break as is.
Yeah.
There is no reason to make things more stressful or make things unnecessarily, you know, mm-hmm. any worse than things already are.
Mm-hmm.
It's not necessary.
Right.
Per se! Anyway, so.
But he ends up throwing a television set in
on Danny Trejo.
Yeah,
that's fine.
So, I mean, again, so at this point, there is no being nice to him.
At least cut him at the... Yeah. No, right, because he's not...
There's... This is the blind rage that we wanted.
Right.
Which, I guess, the killing machine that we wanted.
Yes.
Fine.
Sure.
But, yeah. Before we leave, let's hit Smith's Grove before we go into town.
Oh, right.
So, they call Loomis because he's obviously broken out. We see... Fuck it. Again, cameos. I'm going to keep bringing up the fucking cameos because it pissed me off. We get Clint Howard and Udo Kier.
Yeah!
So fuck off, Rob Zombie.
Cameos my ass.
So, yeah, Clint Howard plays, like, the other doctor at Smith's Grove.
Oh, yeah, yeah, and calls up Loomis and is like, hey, your boy broke out.
Yeah, and they're like, what are we going to do? He's like, I'm going to go get him or whatever. And so...
And this is where, like... reminiscence of Donald Pleasance, Dr. Loomis, kicks in.
Yes, yeah.
Because he's like, oh, fuck. I gotta stop him.
Yeah.
I gotta do something.
I'm the one who's gonna have to do it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And right. Back to Haddonfield.
Back to Haddonfield.
Bum, 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 bum. And I wrote, by the way, years have not been mentioned at all.
Nope. And again, this is 2007.
Yeah.
Yes.
So at this point, an hour into the movie, at this point, is where zombies start. Huh?
Do we get title card here?
Title card?
Title card. We get October 29th.
Though. Yeah. 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 Hey, Jamie Lloyd.
Yeah. Danielle Harris
plays Lori's friend, Annie. Mm-hmm. This poor thing couldn't stay away.
She is good in this.
She was good, yeah.
She's good.
I think she should act more. Unfortunately, I don't think. Did you watch that one dog? Yeah, she had a stalker for a while.
Yeah, she did. I think she still is very afraid of that, which I don't blame
her. God, I don't blame her.
Don't blame her.
Fuck,
I mean,
that.
Somebody stalking a child, we need to get your
She just needs fucking, what's his name? Or Tyler Mayne. Just needs to keep him around. People won't fuck with her.
I'll keep him around. you get, So they're sitting in the library, and it's the first time that Lori sees.
Like, and in all fairness, and it kind of made me sad for Deborah Hill, RAP, because they were kind of talking how some bitches talk these days.
Okay,
let's
get into. I want to bring up the language because this is just swearing just to swear.
That's how I felt in the beginning.
Oh yeah, she says. Judith says something that was like. I can't even remember. It was just like something.
I blocked it out because it was just now. I swear all the fucking time.
Right? And I was thinking,
clearly,
this is just swearing just to swear.
I don't say you need to fucking cut off your nuts and choke on them and die, you stupid asshole shit.
Oh, yeah. I mean, she was just, there's like, one point where she
says, we do say die trash, but that's a little different.
Yeah, usually it's with the Baby Yoda meme that's attached to it. But.
Die trash.
But this was over the top, and I worked with teenagers.
Right,
teenagers
was a teenager.
I was a teenager.
We didn't talk to each other like this.
No, but I mean, I used to sit. My office was like main hallway. Teens. I mean, I heard shit. I heard shit all the time.
Sure.
Never this stuff.
No.
Never this bad. Never.
Like, you need to get fact.
Yeah, it was like it's the point where you're like,
urgent.
Okay, calm down, guys.
Right,
like,
calm your tits.
Yeah, there's no reason to mean every word doesn't need to be fuck.
Oh. Okay, now we see maybe at some point Brad Dourif playing her father, yes. Sheriff Brackett.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Brackett, yes. He's the voice of Chucky.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Tell me that.
Also, he doesn't have a dirty ponytail like he does in the second one.
Oh. That was probably.
He doesn't get the line. I don't remember him
Everyone
saying the line.
Deserves a good skit. No, he didn't.
No, I didn't think so.
Well,
why bring something less?
Because
some
at this, because in this instance, Sheriff Brackett understands where Lori came from.
Well, also, why bring levity in this fucking thing, right?
Or sense, or whatever.
We do. Here's another cameo. Sid Haig is the groundskeeper. So Loomis has come to town, and just like
my next note is with Linda and Bill. Please continue.
Okay. So. They, of course, go to the graveyard because that's Loomis knows where he's going to probably go.
Yeah.
And the grave's gone. And
I know him best. I know where he'll go.
Yeah.
And okay.
Of course, there's a dead fox. Is that what was laying over it?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I wrote dog.
No.
I don't think it was dog. They said what it was.
Oh, shit. They did say what it was.
Coyote.
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 Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because we needed that. We needed a dead coyote link. I'm like, come the fuck on.
Yeah. They couldn't just take the...
No, he couldn't just take the huge marble stone.
Right.
He had to leave a dead animal. Awesome. Right.
So now we're at the night of Halloween, right?
Yeah, and I mean, Annie and... It moves.
It moves real fast. Lori and Annie are going to babysit, but they're not who we go to first.
No! Who do we go to first?
Linda and Bill. Yeah. Totally. I did appreciate, though, that Zombie made her say a couple totally's.
Yeah.
I appreciated that.
And she doesn't get there. She almost gets there, but she doesn't get there. Also, he's...
Oh! I said, at least Linda and Bill's sex is far more realistic. So they're fucking in the Myers house, correct?
Yeah, classy.
Right.
Classy. Because that's what, as a girl... Because
it's an abandoned house.
That's where I want to fuck, is a dirty mattress on the floor. What the fuck is wrong with these people?
Look, like, well, hold on.
Did you fuck in a dirty mattress on the floor?
No.
in a murder house?
But countless cars. Countless cars.
Well, not murder cars. Pretty much the same as in the first one.
Yeah.
Although I did write, Judith is fully clothed, but we get Linda Bush. We get Linda Bush.
Bush was in this movie.
I was like,
I did not see that.
She
must not
had a good enough contract, but yeah, no, sure. Definitely see some dumbaloozies.
Yeah, again.
So Linda's boyfriend goes out to the car to get more beer.
Give me a beer. I know. I was like, yay. I did appreciate that.
So he goes out there and he gets.
I'm sorry, Bill, Brad, Bob gives a fuck.
Stabbed pretty much the same way.
And Linda,
It's not. And he tries to build it up and have that head tilt. And I was like, no, you don't. Again, you don't earn this
you
either.
You don't get to have that.
You don't earn this either, asshole.
No.
But he comes in with the sheet over him and the glasses.
Yeah.
And Linda gets dispatched.
Again, it's replicating almost beat for beat.
Yeah.
Except he does things slightly in a different order and a different way. And not everybody dies. LMFAO. Yeah, so we cut to Dr. Loomis.
Is this in the gun?
Yeah.
Okay, you insist. Okay, yes, yes.
I shouted at my neighbors, my poor neighbors, Mickey fucking Dolenz is selling guns now. I was like, Mickey Dolenz? What the fuck?
I'm a believer. I couldn't leave.
I don't like cameos. Fuck you, Rob Zombie.
Doesn't that make you so mad now?
Yes!
I'm so fucking pissed.
Like, are you kidding me? There were cameos everywhere.
I'd like to take the script and shove it down his throat.
Seriously. Anyhow. Tell me. You try telling me Mickey Dolenz auditioned.
Right?
Fuck you, Rob Zombie.
Yep. Also, love Mickey Dolenz. Anyhow.
No. Not fuck... Exactly.
Yeah.
Not fuck Mickey Dolenz. I fucking love the Monkees for fucking ever.
Oh my God.
And right? Love Mickey Dolenz. He's got the greatest Monkees. Sense of humor. Love Mickey Dolenz. Yes. Yes, 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 yes.
Peter Tork passed away, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yes, I thought.
He was I think Michael Nesbitt.
No one cares about him. Well, he fucked them all over.
Yeah, he did.
Anyhow. Yeah. He was so this is when he goes and murders the Strodes.
Oh, this bummed me out.
So
legit.
We got Mrs. Strode.
Like, why is he killing the adoptive parents? What'd they fucking do?
Mrs. Strode is Dee Wallace. I did get a jump. I did a good little legitimate jump.
Did you?
When he kills Mrs. Strode.
Oh, yeah.
It was, I did get it. I did
get it. I was like, oh, he's there!
Yeah, I did. I actually wrote that. I said, good on you there, Zombie. Thank you.
So what happens now? So Lori's babysitting.
Yes.
After he kills the adoptive parents.
Annie's watching Lindsay and
Annie,
so
like was talked about in the library before.
Mm-hmm.
Annie pre-plans this,
mm-hmm.
and Lori agrees to take
Lindsay over to
who
Thomas.
Annie was babysitting over to where Lori is babysitting Tommy Doyle.
Mm-hmm.
Now I will say, Lori's fucking cute, and with the kids, like
I think she was legit
trying to have fun. Yeah,
yeah,
they were trying to have fun together.
Yeah, and there
like,
was a definitely like a they must have worked with them together. And there is a scene I do like. I do like when we see Lindsay watching television
yes.
and Michael standing behind yeah! watching television. I was like, I like that. I really thought that was
so good.
Really good.
That was so good.
So. I just wrote, it weighs over half a ton. That must be, that's got to be the
The grave.
The gravestone. But yeah. I don't know why this. I've got it in my notes here.
They said it.
Yeah.
I think they mentioned that.
Yeah.
The sheriffs, maybe.
Or
the... No, the graveyard did.
So then we get this line, which I'm trying to remember. It's supposed to be... Oh, okay. So Lindsay and Annie are walking over to Tommy's.
Yeah.
And Lindsay's singing a song because she knows that she's getting dropped off so Annie can go get fucked. And And then so Lindsay says, "We'll pull down Annie's underwear." And I laughed and I wrote it down because I'm like, this has to be a...
reference to fucking Bill or Brad or whatever Brad his fucking name is.
Take off
in
Lindsay's
the first
clothes.
Movie, yeah. Right?
Yep, that had to be what that was.
I didn't even put that together. Oh, that's good.
Then my next note is this movie is fucking tone deaf because the next ones we get Annie talking to Lori about this boy that I don't. It's not Ben. Is it Ben Tramer? I don't think
it's supposed to be. Yes.
It's supposed to be, but I don't know if they even mentioned because he doesn't come back into the second one.
No. No, but I think they did. I remember hearing Tramer at least.
Okay, so she I think they says did. Something. She they says like names. They.
He probably couldn't use any other names. Maybe.
Possibly.
Who knows?
And I just said this movie is tone deaf for even 2007. He uses the word short bus, and I was like,
yeah.
And they use the R word too, and I'm like, yeah. This is 2007, dudes. Meh. You know these are not good terms.
Meh.
There's
no
supposed
mirror.
To make us like these fucking characters.
Right.
I don't like these characters.
No.
I don't like Annie.
Not sad.
Sorry.
Right. Poor Danielle Harris is finally... I said finally killed, but that was preemptive. Annie doesn't die.
Annie doesn't die.
She's quite close, but she doesn't die.
Well, she does, however, get her sex scene with Paul,
which we did not get in the first one. Right. Mm.
But poor Paul. Paul gets hanged.
Yeah, yeah. And we do get Danielle Harris tits.
We had a lot of her tits.
There were a lot of her tits.
She got nice
good boobs. For her. Yeah. Good for her. And they look natural. They don't look...
She looks great.
Yeah,
she's
good
pretty.
For her.
She's a pretty lady. She's older than me, so I can say that.
Sippy
kid. So I wrote, could you fucking... So at this point, Paul and Annie have been fucking in Lindsay's house.
Right.
So, could you imagine Lindsay's parents coming home? And there's fucking dead teens all over your house.
Dude.
Besides the fact that they fucked in your house, but then they fucked and were murdered in your house.
And they're half naked and whatever. Oh, man.
Annie sends Lindsay out alone. Lori does. Lori sends Lindsay out because of the house and tells her to go call the police. But what Lindsay does, she runs back to the Doyle residence. But I was like, you're just going to let that kid run out? There's a murderer out loose.
Yeah.
They look up in the window and his face is there.
Oh.
And Lindsay does the best scream I've ever seen. Yeah. That was fucking balls.
Yeah.
I loved it.
Yeah. Is this where Lori sees Annie?
Yeah, this is where they come looking for her.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's why she sends Lindsay back over to the Doyles to call the police. And I wrote, Lindsay's a good screamer.
Yeah, yeah. That's how you fucking scream.
Yeah,
it is. What's your name? Sarah whatever Moyer.
So Michael's chasing Lori around the house at this point.
Yeah.
So Lori ends up running to the Myers house, right? No. He knocks Lori out. Because he carries her to the Myers house.
He does.
And he lays her out in like next in the basement where he has built this
shrine. Oh, right. Right. Hold on. So I said, okay. So he chases Lori to the other house where the kids are. They lock themselves in the bathroom. The police come miraculously.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
He kills the police.
All of them. Yep.
All of them. Drags a screaming Lori away. Next frame. He's carrying a silent Lori.
Yeah, he must have knocked her out.
What did I miss?
Yeah, I think that's what I
read. Like, they didn't show that.
Did he knock her out at some point? He must, yeah, and that's what I, yeah.
Because
that's when I wrote, please put some clothes on Annie.
Yeah, serious. And then the dad, like, Sheriff Brackett finds Annie and he, oh.
Yeah.
That broke my heart. Like, can you fathom seeing.
Well, he finds her twice.
Yeah, I know he does. Fucking sucks.
So, Linda is, go ahead.
Yeah, no. There's about 20 minutes of cat and mouse. He ain't deaf, girl.
What?
He ain't deaf.
Yeah. Well, first she wakes up.
Yeah.
And she's in the basement.
Mm-hmm.
And Michael has built this shrine.
He clearly has not killed her because... No, right. Because
he gets this moment.
Yes.
Where there is Linda strewn out.
Spread eagle.
Like, crucified almost. Yeah, looking, yeah. In front of Judith Meyer's headstone.
Headstone
which
that he stole.
I didn't understand it in the first one. I don't understand it now. It's fine. It's not Annie. Because in the first one, it's Annie. And this
one,
it's Linda.
It's just one of those things he had
it's
to have.
It's just one of those things, I guess. Whatever.
Because, like... At least in the first go-around, he only killed Judith.
Right.
Which maybe somewhat would make sense.
Right.
But in this one, he killed the whole fam-damily. So I really don't get that.
And then, he takes the mask off.
Yeah.
And pulls out this
picture.
You
still can't really see his face because it's obscured by the fucking nastiest hair.
Yeah.
Known to man. Oh, gosh.
He pulls out this picture and he gives it to her. And good on her, because I'd be the same way. I'd be like, what the fuck are you telling me?
What is this? So it's not like she...
It's a picture of a baby.
She's not
going to
recognize herself.
Right.
She has no idea. She's adopted.
Right.
She has no idea who he is. Any of that.
Yeah. Because even in the Strode house, if you notice, there were bronze baby shoes. So she thinks that there, she's there.
Their birth,
like,
right. Mm-hmm. She didn't know.
She does not know.
Because they had her since she was a baby.
Exactly.
Since she was about one.
I don't really know if they know the backstory. Because at one point when Michael's killing Mrs. Strode, he's showing her the picture. Like.
I didn't remember that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe I didn't
Which
have that.
Which again, how the fuck does he know that? But anyhow. She stabs him in the neck and runs off. Michael Myers Kool-Aid mans through a wall.
As he does in every movie.
Yeah. I mean, he literally... Kool-Aid mans through the entire house.
Yeah. The whole thing.
At one point, we end up... She's in an empty pool. Which, well, good on you, Myers, with your empty pool in the back.
Yeah!
The pool
apparently, they were doing okay.
Boosh.
Right.
Bullshit. So then now we get... Loomis comes and shoots him.
Yeah.
Because
he got his gun from Nikki Dolan's. So now he's ready.
He's ready.
It's not a very good shot, but it's something.
No. It's enough to get him down.
Mm.
And he gets... You know, no one waits around to make sure he doesn't get up.
Yeah.
Like, they go in, they get in the cop car.
Mm.
And he's fucking not dead, obviously.
Right.
Breaks into the cop car.
Oh, right. Because they have that moment that was at the end of the first...
Is this the boogeyman?
Is this the boogeyman? And I'm afraid, my dear, yes, it was.
Yeah.
Actually, my dear, yes, it was, or whatever.
Yeah.
And
smash.
We expect, because we've all seen the first one 100 times, that's where it's supposed to end.
Mm-hmm.
Nay, nay, I say, he's got about, Rob Zombie has about 20 minutes more of jacking off to do. So fucking I'll let you carry that. He fucking smashes the police car window, knocks out or attempts to kill Dr. Loomis or doesn't, like...
I don't remember.
Knocks him out real good.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, I stopped paying attention because I was like,
It was so dark. It was dark. I couldn't hardly see anything. It was the same repetitive shit over and over again. I was like, I don't fucking care. All I know is that she falls through. She pushes him out a window.
Yeah.
No,
she apparently lost part of
a
finger, but I didn't get that. I didn't see when that happened.
Yeah.
She's fucking running around screaming. She's a good screamer. I'll give her that.
She's a good screamer. But they actually both go out the window together, and he lands on the ground, and she lands on top of him.
Yeah.
Then gets the gun and shoots him in the face, and that's where we end.
What did I make? Lame, super mega lame. I also wrote because I watched I don't know about a few seconds of the credits. This really pissed me off, and I texted Ray about this.
Uh-huh.
Based on a film by John Carpenter and Deborah Hill.
It should be loosely based.
Right. Loosely based on a film?
You mean the film,
you fucking hack?
Well, also, you're going to love this. So all of Laurie's outfits, they specifically said all of Laurie's outfits were from the Total Skull clothing line. Guess who's Total Skull clothing line?
His.
Hers.
Oh, his or hers. Oh, how cute.
Like both of them. Fuck them.
Right. No, I did notice her wearing like a skull
sweater. I was like,
Laurie,
which again, never gonna wear that.
Which again was an indication, in all fairness, that it was not 1978.
Yeah. Her clothes were out. Like, it was like, they were 70s inspired.
Ugh.
There were a lot of like bell-bottomy pants.
Make up your mind!
But
sorry.
Like, there was no way in God's... Because I saw that jacket, the jacket with the two flaming skulls in the back. I said, there's no way in God's green earth that Laurie Strode is going to be wearing this. And the other girl was a cheerleader. No.
Nah.
Linda is a cheerleader. I mean, there's a whole thing about Linda being... I mean, these call each other sluts and cunts. And yeah. I'm like, oh my God, guys. No one talks like this.
No, no. You wish they talk like this.
He does.
He does.
Fucking sickle. He can jack off to it. All right, let's do some recommendations. Because we still got in the fucking...
I mean, do we want to bother reviewing this with our blood droplets?
Yes, and... let's just go through.
All right. Blood and gore.
Five.
Yeah. Three. I wrote three.
Okay.
Scary. No, it was not.
I'm going to say it was disturbing.
It was disturbing.
Disturbed. I'm going to say
sure.
Three. Because it was... I was...
Sure. I gave it a two.
Yep.
Dose. Sex/romance. We saw some tits.
I mean, there was some sex.
There was some sex.
Not good, but I mean...
Gave one eggplant and one melon. Because that's about...
Yeah, I'm going to say two.
That was about it.
Yeah.
And fun. Black hearts.
Negative.
Yeah, I would say zero.
Yep. Yep.
It's fucking shitty.
Fuck this movie in the face. I mean, next one is going to fuck it harder in the face.
Look, I thought this one was bad. Man. I thought six was bad.
Give me... Oh my God. I wrote to you. I said, when I was realizing that I was watching eight in Spanish on accident, and I would have gone back and watched you.
I have to read your text. So fucking funny. I couldn't take it. It was so fucking funny. I would rather watch Halloween 6 in Spanish and 7 in French while getting an enema than watch this again. I want to quit. Rage quit!
I was like, 30 minutes from the end. And I was like, I just fucking can't with this movie. Guys, this movie's garbage. Anyhow, all right, so we will be back in two and two, and I'm going to try not to rage or drink more.
I might do the latter, but it's fine.
Okay.
Cheers, my dear.
Oh, yeah.
Slancha, the toast of my people.
Because we're getting fucking into this, guys. This is...
I just had a lovely martini made by Miss Ray. Hey. A dirty
martini. It's
filthy. It is pretty filthy. I love it.
Come on, clean your act up.
So, two.
So, this is got a 22 on Rotten Tomatoes. Rotten Tomatoes.
I find it astonishing that fucking Resurrection got a worse Rotten Tomatoes rating than this shit show.
What was that, 12 or something like that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Can I read the title card that comes up? Do you have it written down?
I tried to screenshot it, but it wouldn't work. Please do.
I have a screenshot.
Please do.
So we open... Smash cut. No, it doesn't work. Open on a title card, which is White Horse. Linked to instinct, purity, and the drive of the physical body to release powerful and emotional forces like rage with ensuing chaos and destruction. Excerpt from The Subconscious Psychosis of Dreams by who the fuck knows. All I know is the second, when I put that in The Subconscious Psychosis of Dreams, and the second one is, can someone explain the white horse thing in Halloween 2? And the third is, in defense of, so I think he made this up.
Yeah.
I think he made this fucking up. Because I cannot find it at all. So I have no production notes because I didn't give a fuck. Because who cares?
Because who cares?
Who cares at this fucking point? And I'm not being like, I'm just saying this is one of the worst movies I've ever seen in my entire life. And that's saying a lot.
Sure is.
But am I wrong? Honestly?
No.
No. Okay, so...
Same style, same night.
Yep.
Well, in the beginning.
Yeah, because when we get a fake out...
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
This is a different Michael Myers. This is one thing I did look up, because they did some screenshots of him to do, like, the flashback scenes in this one, and he looked too old. They were just like, it's 2 years later. That age, it's, you know, touch and go. Like, yeah, honestly, like, you know, in 2 years, you could look, like, 4 years older.
Oh, yeah. So, and he was at that, right at the cutoff age when you start to mature. And
I do have to say, of the two kids, I think, whatever that kid's name was, it's a weird name. I'll look it up. But I thought he was better.
Mm-hmm.
I
agree.
This kid's kind of bleh. Okay, can we talk about the sound effect that comes in when the title card of Halloween comes up? there's like a wow. It was like all these weird sound effects that come up. I wrote, what the fuck was that sound effect? It was like a, it was weird. Did you remember that?
I must not have paid
attention. Oh my God. So the title card comes up. It is the weirdest sound. It's like a slide whistle and there's a something else and it's weird. It's what? Like,
hold on.
It's like a weird, do I need to pull it up so you can hear it?
I just rented this today.
All right, we're going to pause and we'll come back. So it wasn't really weird, but it was weird that it was jarring.
We just quickly we're like, well, no, wait, because I still have it. I rented it from YouTube, so I still have it on my phone.
And it could be because my television, it sounded different too. Because I'm watching it on my laptop, it sounded like. Well, even what they put in here, it was like sounds of chains and like
is that called?
Oh God,
the act, help us.
Oh, the shotgun locked and then it's in a scream. Okay, so we're coming off of Deborah and little Michael talking about, and the last line is no more gloom, no more gloom, and all of a sudden the fuck is happening?
Yeah,
but you know what, maybe this, I'm gonna give him the benefit of the doubt again, talk about things that sounds that will put you on edge and are made to disturb you.
Sure.
And
shotgun, scream, police sirens,
maybe.
All right. Maybe that's just what scares him. Anyway. Okay. God knows. Same style, same night. So it's supposed to be, like in the beginning.
Yep.
It's supposed to be the very same night. And so they take Lori to the hospital. She is freaking the fuck out.
Okay, so here's where I got really confused. Because we are left not knowing what happened to Annie.
There were many times when I could have... Yeah. Because so, I wasn't sure if she was gonna, you know, because it was kind of unclear at the end if she was going to be dead, end up being dead, because she was technically kind of still alive.
Yeah, Annie, yeah.
When her dad got to her.
Yeah. Well, and then we see Sheriff Brackett comes to Lori in the middle of the street. And then we switch right to the hospital and a neck brace. And I'm like, wait, what the fuck just happened?
Mm-hmm.
That's Annie. It took me a good 10 minutes to find out later on that was Annie. Surgery and shit. I was like, wait, what is happening?
Oh, it was?
Yes.
I thought it was Lori.
No.
Because Lori, and then I was like, what the fuck? I don't remember her finger getting cut. And I don't remember, to be fair, I don't remember her finger getting cut either.
Her face was all cut up too.
Yeah.
But I also don't remember Annie's face getting cut up either. But that's neither here nor there.
Right.
But the neck brace and everything, that was Annie. Because I thought to myself, why are they putting on a neck brace? She was literally walking down the middle of the road. There was no reason to put on a neck brace.
So Annie was, because she fell down the stairs, maybe? Or, I mean, well, she was
kind of... I don't know, but then they take her to surgery. She fell on her back. Surgery, so and you think it's Lori. Yeah. It's not. It's Annie. It's
Annie, okay.
Yeah.
But Lori is also in the hospital, and she's being, in between all these shots, among the confusion, Lori's full freaking out. She's screaming, carrying on, and they're like, dude, we need ortho, we need x-ray, we need all this shit. And they're trying to sedate, and they're trying to sedate Lori because she's freaking out, like, he's gonna kill me, he's gonna...
Yeah, I mean, and this is a rough scene. I mean, there were some, like, serious, practical, great practical, I have to say.
Sure.
The cuts and stuff look great.
Yeah, but I still was confused.
Because then we have the next scene who makes it more confusing. Because the next scene is the EMTs. And the EMTs are talking about, it sounded to me like that Annie was dead.
Yeah, because did you get your kids? Yeah, these people are degenerates.
Did you get a good look at the naked chick?
It was N-I-C-E-N-A or something
that. This guy has definitely fucked a corpse.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He says he doesn't, but guess what?
He alludes to it and he talks about some guy. That's like talking about, you know, my friend has this problem. And then, you know, do you have any advice for my friend?
Yeah. Right. Well, and then the horrible...
To be fair, the other guy is like, dude...
Well, he is.
Not okay.
But then he says the grossest joke.
Yeah.
What's the difference between jelly and jam, Ween?
I thought it was jelly don't shake like that.
No, but what is it? You can't jelly your dick up a dead person's ass.
But what does that have to do with...
I don't fucking know!
Oh,
I
just, you know,
we're back
jam
to the...
It. Jam it. Okay.
Yeah, jam it up
see,
there.
See, I don't care to get it.
Yeah. It's just going back to that, you know...
sure.
That all EMTs are the worst, I guess. Right. Cool.
So now we're...
Okay, so they're transporting Michael's body.
Right. Yeah.
This happens. I think this actually happens.
I think it... Yeah, so it's a... It's weird how this starts because there's obvious, I guess, I shouldn't say obvious because it really wasn't, but
no, I mean,
it was kind of confusing, like with it was very, but I get now later, why that was so confusing. And then yet the scenes with the EMTs with Michael Myers in the back was pretty linear. As opposed right. to the, you know, hospital scene. So
it jumps.
Right.
It's like,
really,
he's at the hospital and you're like,
all over the fucking place.
Yeah.
And, well, which, you know, okay, is resemblative of chaos and whatever and, like, trauma and, like, whatever the fuck is going on. So they go, so in the van, they, cow!
Oh, my God. Cow! Oh, R.I.P.D. cow.
I know. Right? Oh, my God. So... I don't know if you'll find this funny or if any of our listeners will find this funny. Feel free to edit out, but I think it's funny. So my boyfriend is playing Diablo 2, the new... It was a newly released, like, expansion or something. I used to play Diablo 2 back in the day. It's the only, like, PC game I ever used to play. Mm-hmm. But it's fucking fun. But apparently there's a... Our gamer listeners will know there's, like, a super somewhat hard-to-find cow level. Where usually you're killing, like, you know, hell demons and,
fucking
bugs and whatever. But it's literally just out of the humor of Blizzard mm-hmm. and its creators. It's literally a level with, like, demon cows. And it's all the, like, creators going, oh, moo. Like,
it's
so
funny.
I love it. He's, like, trying to, like, level up his character quickly. And so he just keeps going to this, like, cow level. And all he's all here
is, it's not like you go out to the woods and, like, kill, like, random things to, like, level up.
In the little forest in the World of Warcraft. Yeah.
Blizzard.
Yeah, they also own World of Warcraft.
I am not a gamer, guys.
I'm only but slightly by proxy because my boyfriend is.
So, yeah, RIPD cow.
So they hit the cow,
and I mean, it is like immediate. Michael is up, and so I don't know exactly.
That wake me up.
It's so fucking dark in this. Yeah, right. It's so fucking dark in this like van thing that I'm having a hard time figuring out what actually happened to the guys in the front.
Yeah,
like, the driver, he's obviously dead, but I couldn't.
But his face, like the driver's face, was there was nothing of recognition.
Right, and. The one guy, the, oh shit, so let me look up, because this is another fucking cameo, guys.
Oh, but I thought, like, that. So the guy in the passenger seat, the real degenerate.
Yes.
Unfortunately, he survives-ish.
That
well,
is
for
Richard
a minute.
Brake. This is Richard Brake, who is another fucking cameo. He's in so much shit. Yep.
See?
He's in The Mandalorian. Everybody's in this fucking movie's probably been in The Mandalorian.
Suck my dick, Rob Zombie. So.
Not Mandalorian, though. I love
no.
Mandalorian. We do get, holy fuck. Okay, so we don't know what's happening. So I'm just going to call him Richard Brake because I don't know what the character's name is.
Mm-hmm.
So Richard Brake is in this passenger seat. I don't exactly know what has happened to him, if he's been...
But it seemed like his jaw became, like, or part of his jaw became detached because he kept going, ah, fuck, ah,
yeah, he's screaming, know? And I don't know what, or he had been, I don't know if he had been impaled in, was something had been impaled in him or what.
I don't know.
But we get, so Michael comes up to the front of the car.
Stretches out. You see the back door's open, and he stretches out his cute little feet.
Yeah, he does gets what my little Bucky does. He stretches his back legs out. He's like, I'm yawning. And he gets a piece of glass and proceeds to cut this fucker's head off.
Like, saw his head off
right?
with a broken piece of glass.
So my note here was, what was the point of that?
Gore.
Yeah, I mean, there was really no point, because he could have just left him dying. He was going to die.
He likes to... Michael's... You know Michael likes to tie up loose ends. He...
I'm giving her a look. So now we get the first shot of Mama Myers in her white... Angelic.
In whatever the fuck
demonic
fantasy zombie
whatever this is in yeah. a giant white horse again the white horse
what's this
in the Knights in White Satin starts to play. And I'm like, you can go fuck yourself, Rob Zombie. Again, you didn't earn this.
No.
And if you're trying to connect the two, go fuck yourself.
I mean, he was. What's the song? It just reminded me, though, of what... What's the song in Silence of the Lambs that Buffalo Bill listens
to? Oh! Oh, my God.
No More Horses or some shit.
God, I love that song, too. Goodbye, horses! Yes! God, I fucking love this song.
Oh, fuck you. Sorry, YouTube.
Would you fuck me? I'd fuck me.
I'd fuck me.
Oh, my God. But so, degenerate cops are dead.
Yeah.
He saws his head off for no reason and just plops it right the fuck there on the street.
Right.
Hey, Octavia Spencer!
And her name's Octavia! I was like, oh, boom. Then I thought, my note was, no Octavia Spencer. We're good.
Alright. I know.
I fucking love that woman.
I fucking love her too. Oscar winning Octavia Spencer. Not thank yet. You very much.
Not yet, though.
She did.
She did.
Oh, but not at this point in the movie. No.
She deserves every fucking.
She doesn't have to do this shit. Well, no. Well,
she did Thunder Force.
But she did Ma.
She did Thunder Force.
Thunder Force?
With Melissa McCarthy. It's bad. It's real bad. And I love both of those women. And
was that before? Pre-post
this was last year.
Yeah. Well,
Jason Bateman's in it too.
I love Jason Bateman.
And he's a man with crab arms. These things all happen, guys.
It's great.
Okay.
It's great.
So, yes.
Anyway.
Ma,
Octavia Spencer.
Okay. I heard Ma's like, okay. I don't know.
I saw it in the theater. I didn't hate it.
Yeah.
I didn't hate it. I enjoyed it.
I just kind of like, I don't want her to be a bad person in a movie.
I fucking love her. She's a good fucking actress.
She is. She's playing. Right? She's playing Nurse Avias.
Right.
Fucking.
Oh.
But we don't see much of her.
No, because she dies quickly dispatched. Pretty quickly.
Yeah. This is where we find out what the fuck's going on a little bit, because this is where Lori comes into Annie's recovery room.
She's like tripping over herself. She's really injured, but then she finds a random
right in the middle of her forehead.
Oh my God, she's fucked up. She finds Annie all fucked up, like on life support, basically. Right.
Yeah.
And then she's like, "Oh, I need." And
Octavia
Spencer's credit, like her character. I don't remember her character's name, but she's
Octavia.
Just like, "Is it really?"
Yes, because I had this
get
close
the fuck out.
I kept saying, "Hey, Octavia." I was like, "You." Okay, I mean, she's probably like, just fine, whatever.
All right,
here for the day.
Fine. Sure. Yep.
Ugh. I'm here for the craft services.
Fine. So she's trying to walk this bitch back. She gets called for an emergency. Nurses.
There's nobody on the floor.
Nurses, you fucking rock the house. You poor things. This poor nurse. She's trying to watch this. She's like, bitch, you need to get back into bed. And she's like, no. And she's like, great. Come on.
She's like, what is going on, my friend? She's like,
and you need to rest. And please, the fuck, come on.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they're halfway to her room. And she gets called for an emergency, page like 8 fucking times. And she's like, can you fucking make it back to your room? You're gonna be okay. Can I trust, and Lori's like, yeah, I'm fine.
And then immediately switches.
Immediately, she's like, I'm dizzy. I need something in my head.
I was like, there's literally a code blue.
Oh, my God.
Someone is dying.
Did you not just hear that? Well, apparently, but Lori's like all fucked up and everything.
That's fine.
It's okay. Okay.
And I wrote at this point, I'm so confused as to what's happening.
I know. The whole hospital thing was really fucked up and really confusing.
The nurses are dead 16 minutes into this.
Right. And we're like, what the fuck? And so Octavia comes back out and, Lori's like, I need something. Do you have something for my head? I'm not feeling it. And Octavia's like, you see something on her nose, what later is blood. And Octavia's like, And you see that she's impaled or something. There's blood starting to trickle from her.
Yeah.
Oh shit. Guess who's at the hospital? Mm-hmm. And
just horribly
stabbed to death.
I mean, it's rough.
It was hard to watch.
It was hard to watch.
That was pretty
gross. And not just because it's Octavia Spencer, but because I was like, that's what she came to do. Like, she's like, okay, you get to kill me in a movie. Like, hey, I'd like to get killed in a movie.
Is that
a movie?
Miss Ray, is that called a cameo?
think it is. Wouldn't it be funny if Rob Zombie was making, you know, cameos what we should have done? Cameo?
You know,
we should save the money up and come home and be like, we can make him say, I don't, that whole fucking quote about we put cameos in your movie and I'm trying. This if is... you would like to help us out with that, please email us at boobsboobsandbloodpodcast@gmail.com.
Is Rob Zombie on Cameo? I'm finding this out immediately.
Oh my god, because we would definitely fuck with him and share it with you guys. Because it would be the most amazing thing. So no Rob Zombie on Cameo. Damn it!
On the Cameo app, however...
Yeah, he's had his own cameos.
He's had cameos.
Yeah, we can't buy a cameo and have him say whatever we want him to say. Fuck.
Like, fuck me, I'm the worst human being on the planet.
Yeah, I love cameos. I heart cameos. Yep.
Rather, I'm the second worst human being on the planet.
Yeah. Alex Jones gets that first.
Yep. Numero uno. There he is. The biggest douche in the universe.
So Lori, at this point, she's...
in the hospital, freaking the fuck out.
She runs out with her broken leg and runs
running
out to a guard
stairwell. Running down the stairwell, right.
To jump to conclusions, Matt, buddy. It's the dude from Office Space.
I knew it was really, I couldn't place it, yes! Jump to conclusions.
His name is Buddy. And poor Buddy fucking gets it. Oh, yeah. Buddy is so sweet. He's get you out of here. We'll get you out of here. And he literally gets stabbed in the back. And
gets hacked in the back by an axe. And then this is where, at some point, Lori wakes up.
Yes, this is where we find out this whole fucking sequence has been a dream.
That didn't make sense. Oh, that's why it didn't make sense.
Right. I wrote fucking dream, fuck you movie, fuck you Rob Zombie.
I know. Interesting. So, quote, that same night, unquote, was just Lori dreaming. Except maybe Michael Myers' portion of it.
So, yeah, also, yeah,
explains why Michael was vocal.
No, he's not vocal yet.
He was in the dream.
With the EMTs?
With Octavia, the nurse.
Oh, because he does grunt later with
I called it grunty.
Yeah, but that's real. Because that's what happens. Because
it happens later, and I didn't. Right. I did at the time. I was hoping that was it, and I said, "Oh nope." Apparently, that's his thing now. Because the white horse rage question mark.
So this is 1 year
Please
later.
Please insert sound cue of Marge Simpson.
Also, I wrote. I don't know if you could hear me rolling my eyes so much, but my eyes almost rolled on my head. So
I definitely felt it because mine did at the same time. I think it was somewhat. You know, like from afar.
I mean, we're only three miles apart most.
I felt it.
You felt it in the cockles of your heart. You felt the rage.
Yeah, we're connected like Laurie Strode is to Michael Myers in this movie.
In this fucking movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so she wakes up and it's a year fucking later.
We're getting there.
And it's a year later. She's living with the Brackets at this point. At first, I was like, is she in a flop house? Where is she living? Because there was like spray paint and graffiti all over the bathroom. I'm like, is she going to shoot? Are we going to see her shoot up heroin?
Yeah, there's like, what is the star thing?
There's a pentagram.
Pentagram. Thank you. They're like, oh, I like the Misfits. I'm like, no, you don't.
Speaking of the Wild Whites of West Virginia, I thought that's where we were fucking going. Sorry, it's like, I'm slamming. But I was like,
Rob Zombie was like, I'm going to pin up the bands that I like. Yeah. Okay.
And it's one bathroom. It's just the bathroom. The rest of the house is okay.
But at the same time, so Lori, okay. So after the hospital thing, we realize Lori's dreaming. Lori wakes up with a night terror.
Yeah.
Trauma.
Oh, yeah.
So she goes to the bathroom, takes some medicine, tries to calm herself down. Next morning, Annie and her dad are making breakfast, and they're like, did you hear Lori last night? And they're like, yeah, you know, what are you going to do?
Right.
Basically.
Honestly. What are you going to do? I'm surprised that all three of them don't have PTSD.
Right?
Right. Especially even Annie.
Especially Annie. I'm like, Annie should be dealing with the same shit. Anyway, so they're like, you know, but Lori's living with them, you know, to kind of like, you know, I'm sure they feel fucking bad. Her parents, like,
yeah,
her
I mean,
life changed overnight.
Yeah, I mean, I honestly think that, like, my family would do the same.
Yeah.
I'm sure your family would do the same.
Absolutely.
I would do it for, like, a friend that, we went through some shit.
What else are you going to do? Right.
You and I went through this shit. Dude. You're staying with me, dude, afterwards.
Right.
At the same time, I think part of it is, like, also, it's survivors together, and you're going through this together. So,
and you're the only people that understand, right, because you were there. Because
you went through it, too.
And so she's living with Annie and her dad, and, like, she's working
Brad
at
Brad gets ponytail. Oh, fucking ponytail. Brad. I'm about to fucking pull it off.
Brad Dourif, this is a message from Wayne. If you ever somehow by God hear this, cut it off!
It was gross.
Not a good look.
No, I mean,
no matter how I understand the attachment to the hair, trust me, I do.
It was not a good look for you.
Just cut it off. You look so much better. Every man looks so much better without a ponytail.
Yeah.
Rob Zombie included, maybe. Agreed. But I don't know.
I want to see what he looks like without a beard.
Look.
It's and true. The dreads.
Anyway.
So then she goes to see her therapist, Margot Kidder.
Margot Kidder, yes.
R.I.P.D. Margot Kidder.
Not a cameo, apparently.
Not, well, no.
Mm-hmm. So at this point, Lori's having premonitions.
Well, she's seeing something through.
Yeah.
Does she know? Well, premonitions, but I don't know if it's just dreams or if she's seeing what he's seeing.
You think it's a dream? But she's. We, as the audience, know.
I don't know, because I don't think Rob Zombie fucking knows.
Well, no. Lori's having premonitions. Does she know at this point that she's Michael's sister? I don't think she was told. Maybe figuring it out. He showed her a picture. He showed her the photo in the first one.
She didn't get it.
But she didn't get it because she's like, what the fuck is this?
Right.
But something is happening. Some kind of connection, premonition, whatever.
And part of me is angry at Sheriff Brackett for not saying anything, because he doesn't. And that comes up later.
He doesn't.
And there's a huge fight because he doesn't. Can we talk about Loomis? Somewhere between...
Hold on. Okay. I know. But before you get there, let me get through these.
Okay,
like,
go for
two
it.
Things.
Okay.
Three things.
Okay.
What the actual... Fuck. Lori's dream where she kills Annie. This is, again, one of the premonitions.
Is it here?
I don't know if it's here. Oh, and just throughout the movie. Like,
I mean,
the movies.
They all kind of
it's
blend together.
Movie, right. It's whatever the fuck. And I go, oh, so she didn't know. And Loomis published it in his book. Fucking
dick. She doesn't find that out until a little later.
Yeah. And because Sheriff Brackett, I think, is like, at some point.
Probably would have told her. But
he might have, but he still wanted her. But she's still having fucking night terrors nightly.
I think he wanted
her
to get to a point where she was a little healthier.
She wasn't fucking ready. Yeah. And she found out, unfortunately, on her own. And that fucking sucks. Anyway, okay. What I do think is interesting, to give a wee bit of credit to Rob Zombie, I like his take on Dr. Loomis. A little.
Do you know what
Dr. Loomis
was for this?
No. Don't. Hold on.
You're going to not like it after I tell
you. I'm
going to.
I'm probably. It's.
You are not going to
burst
like
my
it.
Bubble, but just give me a second.
Okay.
Dr. Loomis really could have gone two ways. The way the prior movies portrayed him being obsessed with protecting people and ending Michael Myers, or, like this, obsessed with his patient's case and ending up a whore for the accolades and the attention that would come from fame. Ruin it!
Rob Zombie modeled Sam Loomis in this film after Dr. Phil. It's part of the trivia on IMDb.
What?
Well, I mean, I see it.
Dr. Loomis, A, does not have a talk show. B,
I mean,
it's not quite the same thing.
No, I mean, I could see. I think I see where he's coming from.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's kind of dickish. I mean, I don't like Dr. Phil. I think Dr. Phil's a dick. I don't think he's a real doctor.
No.
But I also don't think, like, just because you don't like him, I'm not going to go say Sam Loomis, you know, acting in this fashion as, like, Dr. Phil. Because it really isn't.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Just because you don't like him.
Right. And
that's what it is. He doesn't like him. Great.
Sure. Fine.
But you can't, that's real loose ends. That's really, it's a far throw on that one.
But I didn't pick that up. But, it, you know, I get it that he's trying to make a commentary on, he was a fame whore. Well, so are you, you fuck. Anyway.
Right. Hence all the fucking cameos that are in your movie. So, anyhow, so Loomis is doing some sort of...
What, you've never seen a hypocrite before?
Boom.
Anyway.
So Loomis is doing some sort of, like, apology tour. Like, going around the United States going, I'm sorry, he killed all of these people, but it's not my fault. I'm actually doing Donald Pleasance because I can't do Malcolm McDowell.
I can, just a little. Maybe.
Cat people. Cat people.
I can only narrate Great Expectations a la end of season 4 South Park. Thank you very much.
Lori's been working at this, I don't know what, is it a head shop? I don't know what it's supposed to be.
It's a
Dr. Meat.
Coffee shop. It's Dr. Meat's Java something.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, Java joint. So we kind of jump back and forth at this point with between plot line and Laurie's struggles and Dr. Loomis and his book tour.
With his dapper Ted Lasso mustache. I did not want to ride his mustache like I want to ride Ted Lasso's, like a jet ski.
Well, not like, not the same way, but I mean, I'd still jump on. But, so, it's Malcolm McDowell!
No. Maybe cat people. Just gonna keep bringing up cat people.
Jesus
Christ. Again, that was the fucking weirdest movie. He fucks his sister. It's weird.
I did not see that.
It's weird.
Anyway.
They turned into cats.
Well. So Dr. Loomis is a media whore trying to sell his book, and he's like, man.
And he's screaming. So he goes on this, like, oh, God. He literally jinxes it, like, by being like, he's dead. He's dead. He's fucking dead. And I'm like, well, we all know he's alive now, because thank you. Thank you for bringing that into the public zeitgeist now. Thank you.
Yeah, right.
Literally juxtaposes to going to Michael Myers living in a fucking barn.
Right.
And this must be where it went, after he killed the EMTs. Mm-hmm. So,
at some point. Well, because this is a year later.
Mm-hmm.
Or so getting to a year later.
And he's talking about having hallucinations. This is where he starts having hallucinations of his mother. And his mother is, like, putting him on this murder mission now.
Yeah, yeah.
In
his mind. In all fairness.
And, okay, so the next scene is when these hillbillies come for him. I don't exactly know why they're coming for him. I don't. There's no setup.
The hillbillies?
It's Mark Boone Jr. If you need a hillbilly in any movie you're in...
Call this guy.
Call Mark Boone Jr. If you want a hillbilly in The Mandalorian, because there is one, it's Mark Boone Jr. One of the best episodes, but it's in the first season of Mandalorian. Yep. It's also the same one with... Bill Burr.
Yeah. I love Bill Burr.
So the hillbillies are just killing random people they come across. So that's what this is they're going
to... No. They're like, dude, this dude's been trespassing on our property. This is fucking bullshit. I'm going to kick his ass.
Oh, no. I think they wanted to kill him. Because they beat him.
Probably.
But then the woman... Within an issue. I don't know the structure of the relationship structure of this group.
Daddy, girl...
It was very...
Other dude, I'm not sure if that was her...
Firefly-esque, House of a Thousand Corpses-esque, sort of. Because it was this woman who I'm like, okay, is this the daughter, the wife? Because she kept calling him daddy, but who the fuck knows, you know?
Anyway, go ahead, yeah.
Yeah, and she's the one who's like, we can't leave him here. Are we going to leave him here? And she's the one who's showing compassion. She's like,
fucking serious?
Yeah. And so...
And she was like, I'm sorry.
I'm so sorry. Like, because they're getting back in the truck.
But he doesn't get that. Like,
it goes back to the whole fucking thing about women. Because he not only...
It's not just women. It's Danny Trejo, too.
Well...
In the beginning.
So he...
I was good to you.
Right. So he gets up. He's not obviously dead. And he goes and kills Mark Boone Jr. and the other guy. And he smashes the window of the truck and pulls her out and murders her viciously, where he starts grunting. And I wrote down, I'm like, is this what we're doing now? So Michael Myers is grunting now.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, this is where I started getting sick to my stomach. Because I was like, I was already sick to my stomach. But this is where I was like, this is ultra violence against women for no fucking reason.
But it's, no, hold on. It's not just against women. And I'm going to tell you why. Because.
Well, Danny Trejo, I figured.
Right. Danny Trejo, because I was good to you. And it was. It doesn't matter. Once he's there in that blind rage state, he cannot shut it off. Once he's been killing, and that's kind of what happened there in the beginning and here.
I have an idea at the end. I want to talk about how we could make this different. How we could have fixed this a little bit. Because
Let me count the ways.
No, because or something.
Sure. Okay.
Or because
Let's
get through this.
We're almost done.
No, we're not.
What?
We're not even fucking halfway through. Okay, so, Jesus Christ. So now we're at the strip joint.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Well, first we have Laurie Strode still having fucking visions. She's lying in the middle of a dinner table and they're killing her. It's very Texas Chainsaw Massacre-esque.
Yeah, fantasy, the fuck. And it's like, okay.
So now we go to the strip joint, because why wouldn't we go to the fucking strip joint?
Because that's where his mom works, right?
Yeah, right. And so it took me a second.
Yeah.
I'm like, why is he at the strip joint? Why is he killing these people? Because she sent him there. And I'm like, but we're talking 17 years later.
Same boss, maybe.
Do we know?
No.
We don't know. So why is he...
That's not clear.
Why did he kill the stripper?
I don't know. Because he... Again, it's the blind rage thing.
But if she sent them... If she sent them there for revenge, because I think that's what this whole thing was.
He does... Even in the original series, like the, I'm talking 1 through 8, right? 1 through 7, whatever the fuck.
8, yes.
When he kills one person, he doesn't just skip over that guy crying in the corner. He does not do that. He kills anybody and everybody that is within his vicinity. Except for Harold, that was probably his sanitarium buddy. Anyway.
Well, okay, so yeah. But at the same time, why did he even go to the strip joint?
Different directors. Maybe mommy told him to. I don't know. I'm not trying. Why am I defending Rob Zombie?
Yeah, thank you. The case against
Rob Zombie.
Thank you. Okay, so anyhow.
Fuck.
So,
can I talk about the book?
I actually just wrote mean-spirited. I had fucking enough. This is where I texted you and I was like, I'm going to quit.
I quit.
Yeah.
Hold on. Before he's on the talk show, Dr. Loomis, going back to the book.
Oh, yeah.
So, we're at the point where Lori, so what happens is Sheriff Brackett, I don't know, he sees Dr. Loomis on some kind of, on the news or on the talk show or something. He's like, oh, you want to find out, buy me a book. And Sheriff Brackett, who has before, in the previous movie, I think, been like, I read your book, you fuckhole. The first book in the first movie. Gets his second book, reads it, and is like, fuck me running. I told him this in confidence. Fucking fuck, calls Annie immediately and is like, if you find Lori, I need to talk to her immediately.
Also because he gets notice about the strip joint too.
Oh, I didn't know
because
that.
It's all in the same town.
Right. And he's just like, fuck me running. I told him that in confidence. Motherfucker published it.
Yeah.
And what he published was the fact that Lori was adopted and Lori is his natural sister. Michael Myers' sister. And he's like, he's calling Annie. He's like, fuck me, you know, let me know immediately when you see Lori. Yeah. And Annie's like, yeah, whatever.
We also at this point get Loomis's book signing.
Right.
Where the guy from Grimm, which makes me laugh, is the crazy guy at the beginning.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was like, oh, a guy from Grimm.
I know, like, hey, look at you.
Hey.
Linda's dad. Daughter, oh, or dad.
Ripped my heart out.
I know.
So Linda's dad shows up and he's like, oh,
any parent.
Yeah. Because this is like the epitome of what it's like in Ghostbusters 2.
Here we go.
Where
are you paying attention to this?
where the
jump on the train.
The Ghostbusters are blamed for the destruction of the city.
Right.
This is the same thing. Like, is it Loomis's fault? Really? Is it his fault? Did he let him out? No.
No.
So it's not really his fault that he murdered everybody.
I might have an earmarked grievance with the comparison to Ghostbusters 2, but I haven't seen it, so I can't really fairly compare. Sip my martini.
But so Loomis, so Linda's anyway. Father is like, she he has
shows a picture, up at a book signing for Dr. Loomis.
And he's like, you see this? He's like, she's beautiful. She was beautiful. And this is because of you. And I was like, it's really not because of him. It's really not. It's.
But who else has he? When a parent loses a child.
He needs to blame somebody.
He needs to blame somebody.
And I get it. I totally get it.
Obviously, you blame Michael Myers, but he's presumably dead. Or where the fuck is he?
Well, and it's not like Loomis was.
There's
like,
no closure
peace out,
for
I'll
that.
See you guys later.
A parent
keep
never gets closure.
Keep the doors open as I leave.
Right.
Peace. So I mean, part of me is like that happens. I mean, doctors move on to work at other hospitals. They
right.
Work, you know, so it's right. It kind of sucks. And I get
it.
I,
really does. So Dr. Loomis published his book, and then Sheriff Brackett read it, and he's like, "Mother, fucking, fuck, he published it. I told him not to do that." Okay, so I wrote a note. All right. Legally, there is, all caps, no fucking way Dr. Loomis would be able to publish that shit, especially with a current picture of Lori. No way.
Right. As an underage. She's not 18.
Right. She's a minor.
Yep.
Well, at least at the time. I think she may not be at this point.
Right. But when he published the book.
But when he published the book, she was definitely like, no, you cannot do that.
Right.
You cannot do that.
You don't do it in the paper when there's a crime against a child.
Right.
So.
No. You can't. There are certain things in a when you publish a book. I don't care if they are memoirs. You can't. You have to like. You know, it's like fucking Dragnet. The names have been changed to protect the innocent.
It would be
you
back in Jane Austen where you say Mr. A, you know, fine.
Right.
Or
right.
Jane Doe. Or
you cannot
unidentified
do that.
Student.
Rob Zombie, do your fucking research.
Well,
any
I mean, he was
idiot.
Too busy with white horses
well,
and shit.
Obviously.
And making quotes up.
Obviously. All right, so Chris Hardwick and Weird Al. Yay, I love you both.
Lori has lost her fucking mind.
She's lost it, yes, because at this point, she saw the book in the window after, you know, Sheriff Brackett was like, hi, Annie, honey.
Can you find
her?
Can you really find her? I need you
like,
to really find her.
Like, for fucking real?
Yeah.
Like,
no, everything's
no,
fine.
No, that's cool.
Yeah,
everything's great.
Fine. Everything's really good.
But
she's
just
like,
find her.
Dad, are you seriously? What's going on? He's like, no, it's fine. I'll tell you later.
It kind of made me chuckle.
I'll tell you
like,
later. I was like, yeah,
okay.
You should probably tell her now. You should probably tell her now.
Great, great, great.
You should go look for her.
Right. Because Lori, boop, boop, boop. Is petting a pig.
Why does
looking
no one
at
have
sheep.
A cell phone?
I, well...
2007, we had cell phones.
Yeah, okay.
Especially if a murderer has killed, you know, has killed most of your
fuck
family.
Me running.
If most of your...
I'm cut off, officially.
If, like, a murderer has killed most of your family...
Right.
You will have a cell phone.
Mm-hmm.
So then she decides to go get fucking hammered with the girls from Dr. Meat's, whatever place... I was happy I didn't get to see
Dr. Meat's Java Hut or whatever. Java the Hut. Oh, man. Why don't I have a coffee shop named Java the Hut? Probably because there's H in New York. Anyway, well, that's how some people deal with problems. Party! Whee!
So, yeah, they're all going to a party. Like, so she's like, so Lori's fucking wants to go get
she's losing her mind, right? Yeah. She's like, fuck it, let's party! Woo! Mm-hmm.
So she and these two meat sacks go to a party. Where they're all dressed like Rocky Horror Picture.
Oh, right. I wrote, I'm supposed to say this fast. For licensing and copyright purposes, the characters' likeness are not necessarily affiliated with Rocky Horror Picture Show because we couldn't probably buy the rights to it anyway. But that's...
yeah.
Because the one bitch is like, I'm dressed as a dude who wants to be a chick. Mm-hmm. And here's a dude.
Right.
Ah! And I'm like, you're fucking... Dr. Frankenfurter, it's fine.
Right.
But apparently we couldn't get the rights. So, or they couldn't get the rights, I'm assuming. Because she very specifically says that two times.
Right. Once.
And they're clearly dressed as Dr. Frankenfurter, Magenta, and Columbia, respectively.
Right. And so.
Haha, Rob Zombie.
Yeah, right. So, they get to this party, which I was like, for a small town. The fuck this party.
We're fucking banging. If this were not Michael Myers involving Michael Myers, this might actually be a halfway decent movie. Think about it.
If it was a faceless killer?
Michael Myers, right. Mm-hmm. If this had nothing to do with Michael Myers, not Call of Halloween, nothing like that. Take all that away. Take away Dr. Loomis.
Actually, yeah. I mean, it's rough.
It's rough, but it would be all right.
That second half a year
as
later.
As a standalone. Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, if we really, what we said earlier, if we just had it being from, if we want to do his backstory, just do his fucking backstory before he starts killing.
Right.
Mm. Done.
Cheers, Ray. This is putting the booze in booze.
Holy shit, yeah. We needed it, guys. We need it. So.
I needed to get drunk tonight, that's for sure.
Oh my God. So, Lori's like, okay, so what happens is one of the meat sacks goes off with this guy that the only thing I've got in,
Wolfman.
Wolfie. That's what his name is. Wolfie. And this fun, it's so funny. He goes, my drinks are roofie free. Meaning, my drinks are totally roofied.
Right.
Which I was told thrown off. He was really good makeup, because it was makeup. There wasn't a mask. There was makeup. It was makeup. I was like, damn, brother. Nice makeup.
Right, for amateur. Fuck.
Right. That poor gentleman gets murdered. Harley jumps on him like a woman who is going
through. She's just like, I don't fucking care who you are. I just want to fuck.
I need dick
right now.
Yeah, I need my bats cleaned out of my belfry. And you were here and you got a dick. And he's like, ho, ho, ho. And he's like, I actually kind of feel bad for him because it's almost like, talk about consent. Could you say, please consent on this one?
Right.
But
he was like, P.S. Be right with you. Gotta rock
so
a
maybe,
piss. P.S.
He weren't roofied. So maybe.
Yeah.
Then he like gets murdered. And then she gets strangled. Michael Myers literally comes into the van to strangle her.
Which
again.
Is a callback. But it's a callback. Because not everything he does is bloody.
Yeah,
you just have to end.
Annie in the original.
Right.
Right.
But not Annie. Right. But it's not Annie, but it's the same. Right.
In both of these movies, everything's fucking bloody.
Wow.
So, which was unusual.
Yeah.
So, this is when Lori sort of really get hammered. She sees, of course,
yeah.
her mom. Because
she's partying. She's like, fuck this. Let's get drunk.
So, Michael Myers, after he kills Harley, mm-hmm. goes out to the Brackett farm. And murders Annie. Stays in the house because he knows, for some strange reason, that Lori and Maya are coming out to the house. And Lori goes upstairs, finds Annie still alive. Blood everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
This is where I had, I was like, she would have bled out by now. Right. With the amount of blood that was in that bathroom, she would be dead.
Right.
But she hangs on for a good 10 minutes.
I mean, yeah, but in all fairness, but, you know, but she does die eventually.
She does die.
Aw, poor Annie / Jamie Lloyd.
Yeah.
I.e. Daniel Harris.
But at least, you know what? Good for Daniel Harris, because she got shut out of how many different series?
I mean.
Good for her. But then poor Maya, who is a blink. She's the one I remembered, the blonde.
And she was actually compassionate.
Yeah. She gets murdered on the kitchen table. Kind of like what Lori imagines.
Mm-hmm.
No one even fucking looks for her.
In your trippy little dreams.
So Brackett comes to the house because they get a 911 call because Maya's trying to call and saying, shit's going down at the Brackett farm. She's on her cell phone and she's outside and she's reading the numbers on the
house. Oh, right. And she's like, it's 1-5 Cherrywood something or other.
And immediately Michael Myers pulls her inside. Murders her. Throws her on the table, murders her. So they know that the call is coming from the Brackett farm.
It's from inside the house!
So they go, so they find Sheriff Brackett, and they're like, hey, so there's been a 911 call, and he's kind of like, yeah.
From your house.
Yeah, and they're like, it's from your house. And he's booked his ass out to the Brackett farm. And it is one of the most heartbreaking scenes, I do have to say, is Brackett finding his wife or his daughter again.
But this time she is
dead.
For sure. Yeah. Well, and in fairness, one of the sheriffs is like, dude, do not come
back.
Both of them
drag him out of there.
Yeah.
But at the same time, they're like, we also, at the same time, Lori's running through the woods.
She gets to a road trying to flag down cars. And he happens to stop and he's like, oh my God, you know, she's all bloodied and shit. And he's like, it's okay. Let me get you in the car. Let me get you, you know, and he's trying to coax her. And she's like, no, we gotta go now. And he's like, no, okay. Let's just get in the car. She gets in the car. He gets in the driver's seat. Boom, Michael shows up.
Yeah. I don't have...
Kills him. And Michael Myers apparently can lift a car. Did you know that?
Oh, my God. I just wrote...
Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah.
I don't care how many roids you're on.
He flips the car.
He flips the fucking car down the hill.
Fuck you, movie.
Right. Movie magic.
Yeah, not even that. At this point, like...
You can't.
The car is toonsist out down the toonsist! Side of...
Toonsist! I fucking love cliff. Your reference to toonsist.
He pulls her out, and he takes her to a shack.
Mm-hmm.
This is where Loomis
comes back into zombie, in fairness, I also wrote... I don't have many notes after this. Zombie stays consistent with the random combustion of the car.
Yeah, well, like...
Because she's, like, passed out. It's rolled over. She's passed the fuck out because she got knocked the fuck out. Rolling downhill.
Mm-hmm.
And then you see...
Yeah.
The fucking car ignites for no reason!
Yeah. So, they go to this shack. Love shack. Funky little shack.
Tee-hoo! Fast it!
And she meets her mom.
Ugh.
So... At this point...
This is where it got all trippy for me, and yeah, I just tuned the fuck out. Because, so I like three more notes after this.
So you're imagining that Lori sees her brother, her adult brother,
yeah,
sees her 10-year-old brother who's holding her down. She believes she's being held down by her brother, and yeah, sees her dead mother.
Right. And it's totally akin, in fairness, it's totally akin, copied, I might say, from Jamie Lloyd... In 4 and 5, right, where she has this mental connection with her uncle, and in this case, Lori's brother, where Lori is like, you know, she believes so much that her body is reacting
right.
to what's going on in her head. Dr. Loomis tries to snap her out of that with no avail.
So, okay, there's two endings to this.
Right.
So we'll talk about the one that we watched, and uh-huh, then we'll talk about the other alternative ending.
Oh no!
So Loomis shows up. Sprackett's like, "Get the fuck out!" He's like, "But I can help." He kind of like, "I don't want your help," but Loomis doesn't give him a choice.
But not without a well-deserved punch in the fucking nose.
Yeah, yeah. So Loomis goes into the shack. He sees that Lori's being held down by nothing.
Right.
And he's like, you need to leave. You need to come with me. She's like, I can't. They won't let me go. He's like, they're not holding you down.
Right. There's nothing there.
Nothing there. So supposedly Mama Myers gives, gives Michael a look and says, we're ready now. Meaning they're all ready to die. And so Michael viciously murders Dr. Loomis, like stabs him in the face, stabs him in the chest. It's rough. Loomis gets a couple strikes in there
before
he dies, and it's enough to, like, I guess sever the connection between Lori and Michael, so she just now believes she's being held down.
Yeah.
She gets up, she goes to Michael, and she says, I love you, brother, and then stabs him in the chest and then stabs him in the face.
I roll. Oh yeah, but the cop... Simultaneously, there's a helicopter. Yeah. The cops have shown up.
There's a standoff.
To this fucking... Come out with your hands up! Are you fucking kidding me?
So she comes out with Michael Myers' mask on.
Yep.
And falls to her knees. And the scene blends then into the sanitarium. And she's in a psychiatric ward.
Now
and
that's she's how it there. Ends.
And right. She sees her mother and a fucking white horse. So I guess we're meant to believe that she now will be a
framed to her face with, you know, head down, eyes up, and a little smirk.
Meaning she's going to be taking on the mantle of murderer. So
I wrote like 100 eye rolls.
Right.
100.
Or let me get to the alternative.
And that's all I have. Oh, what's the alternate ending? Okay. This will be interesting.
There is one of two alternate endings. Mm. The other shows that the police await a clear shot of Michael in the shed. The side of the shed is broken as Michael tackles Loomis to the ground. Uh-huh. Loomis rips off Michael's mask, is stabbed, and drops to the ground. Lori's visions do not disappear. And as she leaves the shed, she is herded by her mother, and she approaches Michael's lifeless body. She grabs his knife and moves towards Loomis and collapses. She appears to be comatose, yet is interpreted as ready to stab him and is shot 3 times by the police. The camera later transitions outwards, revealing the 3 corpses of Michael, Loomis, and Laurie. It zooms in on Laurie's head and then transitions to the scene of her in a psychiatric ward. Cool. Coolio. And that's this fucking piece of shit.
Jesus God, are we finally done?
It's
fucking...
Right, let's get the fuck out of his world.
No, right.
Let's go to some
ratings. Let's get ratings and then we're done.
Okay.
Blood and gore.
Oh, God. 4 or 5. I mean, it was pretty
fucking
gory.
Yeah, I'm
going to
give it 4, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Lot of gore. Mm-hmm. Lots of it. Especially Jesus, Annie. Fuck. Mm. Fuck me.
Oh, and the EMT gets his head cut off by a piece of glass.
Sawed off.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, spooky scary. What's the next?
Oh,
I wrote like half a one.
Yeah, I mean,
it was not scary. It was just gratuitous violence for no fucking reason. Sex/romance. I gave it two melons. There were a lot of boobies everywhere, especially at the party.
Oh,
there were a lot of boobies, but whatever.
And kind of sex, but not really. Yeah, he doesn't get any.
Fun/entertainment. Instead of a black heart, I gave it a shit poop emoji. How about that?
Yeah, I mean,
how do you like that, Rob Zombie?
Yeah, I think
come for me.
Okay, let's get the fuck out of this. So we're gonna do some fun stuff next week.
Yay!
Or next time. We're talking
just hear those cheese bells tingling.
No, yes. We have Halloween 2018.
Fuck.
Which I've seen and I enjoy, so I know it's better. And then we have,
as long as we agree on,
Halloween Kills, which is the second in that. And then so we're finishing up. This will be finishing off Halloween. We are done. And then until next year when Halloween Ends comes out. And then after that, for our Christmas.
Yay! Just hear those sleigh bells jingling, ring ting tingling too, as I pour this wine.
We're going to do Black Christmas, the 1970, and then we're going to do the remake in 2019, I think it is.
Sweet.
That will be our Halloween or a holiday episode. And then we'll come back in January, and we're talking about what we're going to do then. And then in February, we're going to do Candyman. So let's talk a little bit real quick. Let's do recommendations of things that we've seen, and then we'll get the fuck out of here.
All right. Who wants to go first?
Go for it.
Okay. So I've spoken before that I'm a basic white bitch, and I enjoy true crime. There's a wonderful... And I also enjoy documentaries.
Mm-hmm.
i.e. true crime, whatever. There's this wonderful documentary on HBO Max called Crazy Not Insane.
Mm-hmm.
This is a very fascinating introspective. It's a documentary described as a provocative look at the minds of serial killers through the lens of a renowned psychiatrist, Dorothy Ottenow Lewis. She's well in her years. She seems semi-retired or something. And, like, her son is helping her make this documentary.
Ooh.
She has interviewed tons and tons of serial killers and been a... Again, you know, the more education, the more information, the more you understand about why... Because so many people, when there are serial killers about, you know, you always wonder... Why? What made them do what they did?
Mm-hmm.
Except for horror films, because I think that's bullshit. For whatever reason, I'm a giant hypocrite. But when it comes to people like Jeffrey Dahmer, John Wayne Gacy, Ted Bundy, you know, all these people, she does talk about it. It comes a lot later in the documentary, but spoiler, she did have some interviews with Ted Bundy.
Mm.
Because he was trying to defend his own case at some point when he went through like 50 lawyers.
Where he was saying it was all about porn.
What isn't such common knowledge is that a lot of these same people suffered physical
head injuries.
Mm-hmm. Head injuries. You look decades later at football players.
Charlie Manson?
Yeah.
Yep, head injury.
But you look years later, decades later at football players.
Oh, my God.
With constant head injuries. Right. They either kill themselves or kill other people or both. The wrestler,
what's his name? Chris Benoit. Right. Wouldn't have murdered his family if he didn't have CTE. Yeah.
People called it roids. Anyway. Awesome. Crazy, not insane.
Coolio. So I saw Ghostbusters Afterlife, guys.
You saw it twice?
I saw it twice.
Bitch!
I went myself.
I thought we were supposed to go.
I went once and then I took my parents.
Oh, nice. Well, that's
great. I mean, I will see it again with you.
Yeah.
Because I figured we were going to do it for the show.
Yeah, we fucking will.
You have to see too. Ghostbusters, there's something, it's been with me. I mean, I used to play with the toys.
That's correct. The man has no penis.
And no dick.
No dick.
William Atherton. what in the hell are you doing? Anyhow, it's so good. It's like, it is a love letter to the fans. And as much as people are shitting on it because it is a love letter to the fans, that's what we're here for.
Right.
That's why this movie
are we not? Are you not entertained?
I mean, I don't want you to, like, to cater to me and to, you know, to placate me. But at the same time, like, there was enough story that I was like, okay. I cried at the beginning and I cried a lot at the end.
And sexy Paul Rudd.
Oh my God. And it hit baby Paul Rudd in it.
Sexiest man alive!
And he looks great in it. He's so funny in it. So handsome. He gets with Carrie Coon, who's gorgeous. So it was, and the girl, and I mean, I'm not ruining anything. It's the Spengler's grandkids. So, and Spengler's was my favorite Ghostbuster. Ooh. I cried when Harold Ramis died. It was just,
I know.
It's rough. And the little girl looks like,
sorry.
Looks like Harold Ramis. Like, she looks like Egon. Really? She looks like Egon.
Aww.
And she's just nerdy like Egon. It's just, it's really great.
Gone too soon.
I mean, if you love Ghostbusters.
To Harold Ramis.
Yeah.
Gone too soon, for sure.
If you love Ghostbusters.
Amazing director.
Yeah, yeah. See it. You'll enjoy it. You won't regret it. If you don't follow us on social media, our Instagram is boobs and blood podcast. I know that one was a shocker.
We're on Twitter.
Our Twitter is at booze, boobs and blood. Sorry, at booze, boobs, blood. There's no and. And our TikTok, which we have, and it is just going to be just clips
just
from the episodes.
Heard this today, folks, that we have a TikTok.
It's just clips from the episodes. We couldn't because there is a community control warning, so it is Triple B podcast. All right, let's sign off on this bitch. Signing off from the Booze, Boobs, and Blood podcast.
Fuck you, Rob Sam. Rob Zombie. It's like Zab Rombie.
I'm Ray,
and this is Wee.
And we'll check you later.